Steve, you're out of the room there. Mm-hmm. Carl took a phone call from someone.
Okay.
He's found a cellmate.
Right.
Not a soulmate. I think one day they will be cellmates.
Yes.
Because he's just like, he loves everything Carl loves, and he was telling Carl stuff, and Carl's face was lighting up.
Yeah.
He's told him of two Russian kids in the circus. They're covered in hair, and their mum tells them off because they're covered in fleas. Carl said, see, that annoys me again, innit? They do something else. And the bloke went, yeah, they should just make money out of being hairy. And Carl went, exactly. And he said, have you heard of the three-legged juggler? And the bloke went, no, what's that? He went, that annoys me as well. Because he thinks they shouldn't have done juggling, they should have done football.
Do you know what I mean, though, Steve?
What do you mean a three-legged juggler? What are you talking about?
He's a famous three-legged juggler.
Oh, he's mega famous! He's like the Beckham of wherever he's from.
But the other day I was looking in, I don't know, Bizarre magazine or something, right? And there was this fella who, he had no arms. So you saw a picture of him, his job was fixing watches, did it with his feet.
Go on.
Well, it's just, why pick the most hardest job to do when you haven't got any hands? Crush grapes. Or... Do you know what I mean? That annoys me.
Oh, crush grapes! Imagine him being told that, and that he comes into the careers advisory where I go, now, what do you want to do, Hargreaves? Make watches? Right, take a look at your arms. Crush grapes, mate. Sorry, you're a grape crusher. Next. Brilliant. Brilliant. I would love you to be a career advisory in some sort of clinic. It would be brilliant.
I love the fact that it annoys you. Here's a man, he's got no arms, he has learned to fix watches with his feet.
Yeah.
An incredible talent, incredible skill, he's utilising that brilliantly. That's annoying to you, you are angered by it.
Right, I'm only being honest. Now you be honest, right? Your watch is broke, who would you go to? You're in a rush, you need it fixing in a rush. Now, you need some fresh wine.
Be honest.
Oh, you're amazing.
But what's this thing that you've been talking about, this video?
Freaks. Right. It was a thing that was banned for, like, 50 years. I think it's been taken off again, but I don't know why, if it's just been deleted. Right? It's a quest. If anyone out there has got a copy of Freaks on DVD or VHS, can Carl borrow it, please? I almost want to set up a camera to see him watching it. It's absolutely real. They use people in the circus of the time. I think it's the 20s or 30s of the Depression. And there's people, there's Coneheads, there's a bearded lady, all genuine. There's a bloke they call the Human Slug who's got no arms and no legs, Carl. And he's just there, and he rolls a cigarette and lights it with his mouth.
I think I've seen his brother, who isn't called the Human Slug, is called... the pillow.
Right. How does he make a living?
Does anyone want to meet Carl for money? Do you know what I mean?
The annoying thing was, right, there was a picture of him. I was going to put it on
I've seen his brother.
On our website, we put things up like this, right? If you go to ricky.gervais@xfn.co.uk/...
What? You put things like that on my website? It's nothing to do with me. I want people to know that that website is not kept or looked at by me. So, what have you put on there?
There's a fella on there who's known as the Pillow. And he's, you see, I get a bit worried with things like this, because we're not sort of having a go or anything. It's just things that
fascinate you.
Yeah. And, yeah, it's a guy, it might be the same sort of thing. What's your one
I bet you used to stare at people with goiters, didn't you, when you were little? In Tesco's.
Well... just go to xfm.co.uk/Ricky, it is.
What's the worst thing you've ever seen on, like, a human face?
You know what it is, and
what
I
is
don't
it?
Want to talk about it.
I can't remember. No. Have you told me?
Yeah.
What is it?
But go,
it's not
go
the
to,
elephant lady.
Go
that
to
you
the, yeah.
Is it the elephant lady? You talked about that,
I know. Yeah, I don't want to talk about it again. Go to the website and see the human pillow.
Why is he a human pillow?
That's what annoyed me. I thought he was more of a draft excluder.
Things are flying here at XFM. People have called in. There is a video of Freaks on the way. Carl's going to see that within the week. That's exciting. That's exciting for me. Do you know what I mean? About our education of Carl. We started off trying to teach him about science and history, and now we just find that he likes pictures of hairy Chinese kids and
who
women.
Doesn't?
Who doesn't? No, true. You've got a theory about pictures of Freaks, haven't you?
You see, you always bring things up that I don't want to talk about, because I'm really worried that people, if you've just tuned in for the first time, it's the first time you hear it, and we're talking about airy Chinese kids.
Yeah.
Talking about the human worm.
Carl, listen. People don't think that you're taking the piss out of those people. They lump you in with them. Do you know what I mean? They think that you're a freak of nature. So you can say anything you want. Do you know what I mean? Because it's honest, it's from the heart, it's genuine. So, don't worry about
that. Yeah, but Suzanne was saying last night that I've got a heart of stone, or whatever it is.
Why?
Because I wasn't crying at Comic Relief. And all I was is to say to her, get out Elephant Man, let me watch that for 30 minutes, I'll be crying my heart out.
Why? Why do you care about that but not...
Because that is more real, isn't it, right? Think of John Merrick.
Sorry. What, the film starring John Hurt is more real than footage of starving people in Africa?
No, but what I'm saying is, think about... See, this is why I didn't want to bring it up, because people are gonna just say...
Well, you're allowed to cry at what you like. People can't have you for not crying at someone and crying at someone else.
Imagine that, like, if you've seen the film, you know, his head's all, you know, messed up and that.
Yeah.
He's getting picked on all the time.
Yeah. By Michael Elphick, I remember.
Yeah.
It's just really, really sad. Whereas, you know, we try to help
out. But you give him a bun and he forgets it.
Do you know what I mean, though?
He never forgets, really.
Oh, dear.
Anyway.
Oh, God.
We're giving away stuff again.
Yeah.
Tell me your
theory about freaks who have their picture taken.
No, I'd leave it.
Can I tell you what this is?
Go on, quickly, what is it?
Right, when he sees a little picture, like, in these books he's got, he carries round those things, right? And there's, like, a fella with a little head with some, like, able-bodied people. He goes, the only reason, he must know the only reason they got to take that picture, right, was so they could show their mate, say, look at me, the little fella with a little head. That's his theory.
Yeah. So every picture of a freak, they're
right,
being-
Steve, let me describe the picture to you. This little fellow with a little head.
Right.
Playing on the piano.
I've seen it.
All his family stood around, and mates and that. When have you ever seen a picture of someone playing the piano and everybody wants to be in on it? Right. Doesn't happen.
Maybe it was one of those kind of Christmas cards they sent out to everyone.
It wasn't. You could see one of them was like in a rush to go away. He was probably planned to go out. And he was like, but they were taking a picture. It's, oh, I'll be in it then before I go out. And it was all, he's out of order.
Yeah.
If you say, do you know the one I mean?
I do know the one you mean, yeah.
What about the one in the, when you went down to Cornwall, in that little
we'll
pub?
We'll talk about that next week.
What, do you want to get on, do you? Yeah.
Yes, we've also got a new feature, Cheeky Freak of the Week. We haven't done Cheeky Freak of the Week.
That's a new feature,
yeah, that's a new feature.
Cheeky Freak of the Week. Let's do Cheeky Freak of the Week. What is the cheekiest freak of the week? So, I'm just going to apologise now, I'll just add, freaks, sorry to freaks. Okay, right, go ahead.
Well, I say it's a new feature, but we've sort of touched on it in the past with-
We always talk about freaks.
Hairy Chinese kid.
Yeah.
We've had, the Pillow Man.
Yeah. Are you called the Draft Excluder?
Just make a note of that, would you, Rick, on this?
Yeah. People without arms and legs.
But at least, you see, the Pillow Man, what do you picture? Because I was saying to Ricky in the week, right, I'm a great fan of the Elephant Man.
That's his favourite freak.
Do you know why he said,
because you get what you pay for. When someone says the Elephant Man, you get what it says on the tin. Right. You know you're gonna get it.
Yeah. Do you imagine, Steve, if you had a mate and you said, where are you going? He said, I'm gonna see my mate. And you go, which mate? And he said, the Elephant Man.
Yeah.
Straight away, you haven't even met him, but you know what he's gonna look like.
Yes.
Right? That's what I like about that. Airy Chinese kid.
Yeah, you know what you're gonna get.
Pillow man.
Yeah,
not so good.
What does that mean?
It could be one of those big fat things on that show, couldn't it? A big pillow, like a.
Yeah.
You know that big thing about the fat people in feeders? They were getting up to like 60 stone and that big one. And there's a thing called fat admirers that just fancy fat women, right? And
you writing that down?
Yeah, sorry. And they had blow up versions. It looked like a bouncy castle.
Wow.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. You'd be knackered when you blew that up.
Yeah,
you just wouldn't want to go forget it.
Yeah.
Oh, God,
that's people being cruel as well, isn't it? Because after watching the programme on Channel 4 about the, you know, the fat people and fellas who like them and stuff, there was a story on one of the news websites about some fella in Germany, right? It was a big fella. must have been about 50 stone, and he fell over, right? And I think he hurt his ankle or something. And
Timber!
They sent firemen instead of, like, an ambulance.
Yeah.
So straight away they're having a bit of a laugh.
They're not, no, they've got winching gear.
Well, they didn't, no. They didn't have winching gear. They had to use the hose pipes.
What?
To carry him out. I think it was Ananova, that news website. They had to use the hose pipes. So they made, like, a bed using the hose pipes.
Oh, yeah.
And had to carry him out on that. And then they had to sort of get him into a special truck, they said.
Mm-hmm.
And do the same when they got to the hospital. I mean, that's a bit...
That's mad, isn't it?
They shouldn't do that.
Although, Carl, I'm loving that story. I'm just worried that we're not going to be able to fit in Cheeky Freak of the Week.
What's so the Cheeky Freak of the Week?
All right, Cheeky Freak of the Week. Something I found on the net.
Yeah.
A fella who had 27 toes and fingers.
In a jar?
No, still on him. And proper ones as well, not like little stumps and that. Proper, fully formed fingers. He was had, like...
Was he a pianist? Close-up magician.
I don't know what he did. He just said that. That is
cat's cradle professional.
Did he ever work on finger bobs?
He was saying in the week
for the crowd scenes.
I'm now going to do Braveheart.
Yeah.
He said about the Elephant Man. He said, "I want to do a thing right with freaks, where it's good and bad." He went, "What you said? The pro about him is."
What about the fellow with loads of fingers, or...?
No, the Elephant Man.
Well,
he said the bad thing is he stretches his jumpers.
When he puts them on.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what's the good thing?
Sort of, he never gets up and goes, "Oh, my hair's a bit of a mess today."
No. He's always having another bad face day.
I'd like to complain about this head and shoulders. Are you taking the piss?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
So that's freaky.
Didn't you see an elephant woman in Manchester?
Yeah, leave that.
What do you mean, leave it?
No, because it is sad.
I know it's sad, but I mean, I don't know what my next sentence is.
No, people always
that
think.
Should be the end.
Did I don't it need to say anymore. People will know what she looks like. It's a good name for her.
Did she like buns? Oh dear!
It was when my dad was a taxi driver, and I used to sit in the front.
Yeah.
And she used to get a lot of taxis.
Yeah.
And
he only charged you half price, didn't he? He was a good guy.
Well, the bad thing is, as well, with people like that, you don't want to offend them because they never forget.
Oh, go, right.
But,
go, Pilkington!
I was sat in the front of the cab, and my dad goes, "Right, we're going to go and pick the, you know, the." I'm not counting to tell you the name of these guys, it's just evil. Right?
What do you mean?
No, leave it, so she's got-
No! Carl! Tell me what he said!
No.
You've already stitched him up with Stephen things from Little Welsh
I
Fellas.
Don't care.
Right, what did he call her?
Steve, back
no!
on this, I really don't want
to-
Carl,
our opinion of him is already pretty low.
Look, tell me what he said.
No, it's not, I'm scared of what my dad gets, it's the person who's got-
She's not listening, is she?
Well, her headphones wouldn't fit on her head.
Tell me what he called her!
I don't want to.
Tell me what he called her, Carl. I'm getting angry, man. Tell me what he called her.
No, I'll leave that. Honestly,
tell me what he-
It doesn't matter.
Tell me what he called her! Carl, just- I'm
Steve.
Gonna go-
I want to know what he called her.
Right, you're not gonna stop this show. We're not doing the next show until you tell me what he called her.
What did your father call the elephant head woman?
Tell me!
Spudhead.
How old were you?
I don't know, about 9.
So did you expect to see a potato with a dress?
He did sort of, again, it's a good name. Do you know what I mean? I had an idea of what it was going to be about, and he said, "Do you want to stay in the car? I'll take you home because you can't."
Spudheads, you've got lovely eyes.
Can't.
Carl, just remembered, we've got Cheeky Freak of the Week to fit in. I don't know what to do. What's your Cheeky Freak of the Week, quickly? Just throw that away.
Right, well, it's just like, you know, we look at Cheeky Freaks.
Is this show offensive in any way to some people, do you think?
Ding dong.
Got any buns? Oh, it's the Elephant Man. Go on.
Right, well, it's a bit of a problem for you, this one, Steve, right? I'm chucking it forward to you. Remember the Cheeky Freak of the Week that we were talking about? That illness where people age quicker?
Mm. The 5-year-old girl that was older than her mum, and he said to you,
What, if you ran off like you wouldn't serve her fags and beer? And you went, no. He went, why not? And you went, because it's a 5-year-old.
Yeah.
Right? He went, oh, she's got enough problems. Give her some fags. You remember that,
yeah,
don't you?
Yeah, sure, sure.
Yeah, right.
So, another dilemma for you, right? Picture this. You run in a restaurant, right? Door goes, right? Few people. Most of them look normal. You notice the woman at the back, crawling on all fours. top half is woman, right? This is real. Yes. This isn't like a comic or anything. This is on,
yeah,
on the internet.
I've seen it. They're called dog people, and her legs just come straight down. They're like little, there's been legs at the back, and so they walk on all fours because it's easier.
Dog people, right?
Yeah. You've not dog people. They're human beings, right, with, yeah, deformed back legs, so they walk. It's easier for them to get around like that because they can't, stand up because they can't stabilize, and also it comes straight out of their hips.
Right.
Right.
So you're running a restaurant. It's a busy night. You haven't really got time for any hassle. She comes in.
Uh-huh.
Would you serve her?
The premise being what? That he doesn't serve dogs?
Because the restaurants don't allow animals in.
Right! She- Right. Right.
So it's a dilemma.
It's not a dilemma. Right. She's not a dog. She's a human being.
Yeah,
with
I put, you know, a plate of meatballs on the floor. And she tucks in. And a little glass of, you know, a little bowl of wine. Next to it.
He turns round, there's the woman older than...
Get away from that plant!
Have we got a cheeky freak of the week?
Do you want one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we should have a jingle for this.
Okay, I've got a jingle. It's very similar to chimpanzee.
Chimpanzee that?
Yeah.
Well, let's hear it, let's hear it.
Okay. Oh, cheeky freak of the week!
Brilliant. Brilliant. Yeah, no, I think that's excellent. So, cheeky freak of the week, you've spotted a freak
this week? This is where somewhat, I think, offensively, you pick on someone who's not like other people and say it's your favourite freak of that week.
Yeah,
I remember we had the woman whose, legs look like the hind legs of a dog. We've had the little fella with the ageing disease with a little head playing the piano. That was your favourite. I think that's your probably freak of the year, isn't it?
It's a pretty good one.
So, what's this? Is it a man with a horrendous injury, or is it a congenital, birth defect, or what?
Yeah, but you put it like that, and now it sounds like I'm being tight. Sounds like I'm being out of order. But I'm just giving him a mention.
Just giving him a big shout out.
Right. Yeah. There's quite a lot going on in the freak world.
There always is.
You've been visiting hospitals the last week, have you, when we were away?
No, there was, there's a thing on a website. This isn't even the one that I've picked, so...
So this is just a bonus?
This is a bonus freak.
Jeez, yeah.
Yeah, go on then.
This is a free freak, right? Yeah. It's a fella called the Lobster Man.
The Lobster Man, of course.
Again, good name, you know what you're gonna get.
Yeah.
Right. What are you gonna get? Some succulent meat.
I like the idea I like the idea that the vicar on the christening suggested that. I know you want to call him Mark. Can I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
Look at his hands.
What's his name? Mark Michael Webster. Right. Right.
Have you thought about a nickname?
Not really, no. Have you
looked at his hands?
Yeah, we don't want to talk about that because
it's a little bit like lobsters.
Well, yeah, but it's quite deformed. It's a, like, you know, we
can't. Can I suggest Lobster Man?
That's terrible, Vicar. That is terrible, Vicar.
Pidgey.
Go on then. We're gonna see. This is what the sort of feature you come up with, Carl.
So, Lobster Man.
There's probably people listening now with, you know, lobster feet.
Right.
Lobster hands.
So,
Squid Boy.
So, Lobster Man, what does Lobster Man do? Does he fight crime?
Not that much.
Okay.
Apparently he got into a bit of trouble. He was in a restaurant. And, this was years ago, by the way.
And someone picked him to eat him.
No, so apparently the waiter, said, oh, you shouldn't be sat here, you should be in my pan. Or something.
Oh dear.
And it, they had a fight. Got out of hand.
Yeah.
Oh, got out of claw.
And, so that was-
What do you mean they had a fight? What did he do? I mean,
what did he do?
A waiter took the mickey out of someone with-
Now, can I just make clear, I'm assuming it's his hands look a bit like those of a lobster.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's fused, so it's just like two big fingers. They're fused, I assume, probably in the womb, and they're just like, instead of like having five digits, they're fused and it. But I mean, he can pick stuff up, can't he?
Yeah.
What does he pick up? He mainly eats crabs and jellyfish, doesn't he?
Yeah. Yeah. So he was having a fight with the waiter, he snipped off his nose.
Right, so anyway,
he just held on to the waiter's bib.
Yeah.
And the waiter was screaming, go and get him off me.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Anyway.
Does he eat other lobsters? Does he think he would eat lobster? Or is it kind of would he feel bad about eating lobster?
Right.
The little cheek of the freak that we've gone for anyway.
The what?
The little freak of the week. Yeah. Cheeky freak of the week. Mm. We've gone for this Siamese lad.
Okay.
Right. Happened back in
you can't have a Siamese lad, can you?
Alright, yeah. This Siamese twins. Happened back in 1693.
Oh, he's got a date. Blimey, that's the first time ever.
Yeah. And all it was, he was doing alright for himself. He used to go on the like those circus things he used to do.
They're two people you're talking about, Carl. So we're going to him.
Alright then. Alright.
They
did this circus show, right?
Yeah.
And everything's going well. They're selling out the tents and stuff, people coming to see them.
Yeah.
He was doing all right for himself.
Yeah.
Right?
Sorry, before I said that, did you think a Siamese twin was a man with two heads?
Well, it can be, can't it? It depends.
There's two people, they're conjoined.
No, but it depends, doesn't it? The one that I shown you in that book that time was a fellow with two heads.
No, it wasn't. That was a stupid picture in one of your stupid books that he had a growth that looked a little bit like it had a face on it. It wasn't a man with two heads. You're the same sort of people who send potato chips to Esther Hansen and say, doesn't it look like Norman Cook?
Yeah.
It's not two heads.
We'll bin this feature.
No!
No, it's just,
they're two people. They're two people, conjoined twins. Yeah. Right. So these.
It's just they just happen to have a similar taste in clothes. Okay.
Anyway, so they were doing all right, and it all went wrong when he crossed the road, got run over. The lad with two heads got run over. That's it.
What? How is that cheeky freak of the week?
Just because it got my interest, and I kind of thought, why don't you just look both ways?
I'm intrigued to know
Wasn't he looking both ways?
I'm intrigued to know how you get run over. What was it, 1629?
Yeah. Well, it's horses and that, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, why wasn't he looking both ways? Carl Pilkington, you are a genius.
Like I say, it's been a struggle. We'll do that. We'll do Cheeky Freak of the Week. Do you want to?
Oh, definitely. Should we do Cheeky Freak of the Week?
Cheeky Freak of the Week?
I can't wait. I'll always do these. I'd start off with these.
All right, well, let's have the jingle for Cheeky Freak of the Week.
Oh, no.
Do you remember it?
No.
I remember it.
Oh. Oh, Cheeky Freak of the Week.
Brilliant.
Something like that?
I want some more, because that was slightly half-hour.
Oh, Cheeky Freak of the Week.
Excellent.
Right. This, we're going back again.
Yeah, 17th century.
Well, it was 1829, right?
Oh, I'm impressed.
Now, the problem is with Cheeky Freak of the Week.
Not so much the week, is it, if you're going back to 1829?
Well...
Not even of the century. You haven't even done Cheeky Freak of the Century.
There's...
What's the problem with Cheeky Freak of the Week?
Just because...
Other than the sort of moral implications.
Yeah!
Well, last week, it was a fellow with two heads.
Yeah.
Mm.
We've done Siamese twins. It's Siamese twins again.
It was Siamese twins. It wasn't a fellow with two heads last week. It was Siamese twins. Conjoined twins, sorry. They're two different people. Mm. This is what I'm telling you.
But this is the problem. They're going to crop up quite a lot just because they've got double a chance. Alright?
Oh, please don't write in and complain. He knows not what he does. You understand, don't you? Carl will actually feature one day in this section.
Yeah.
So, right, go on, Carl.
We're going back to 1829.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All the way back there to 1829.
It's a retro conjoined twin link.
A couple of guys set up a business. They were called Chang and Ang.
Oh, they're the first. That's why they're called Siamese twins, because they weren't. Wasn't that what it was based on? Those two, Chang and Ang.
Was it
the original? Yeah, that's why they're called Siamese twins. Because I think they were Siamese.
So these are the first ones.
Well, not the first ones, but they're first the ones that got to fame, I think, and why people started calling them. The people started calling conjoined twins Siamese twins. I think I'm right there.
Anyway.
Yeah. Well, the sort of set up business, sort of going around the US.
Well, both of them.
And Europe, yeah.
Yeah.
And what they used to do, people were amazed by it anyway. Yeah. People wanted to know how they get through life doing certain things that you think about. When you think about Siamese twins, you think about you know. How do you get through a day like that?
Yeah. Right?
And the thing that cropped up the most with people was how they take a bath. So they used to go on tour around the US and Europe and sit in a bath. have a wash and that. And
did they ever wash each other by mistake? They go, oh, that ends there. That ends there. Like those things in supermarkets. They'd put one of those down. We go, oh.
What do you mean?
Put that there.
What do you mean?
You know the things on the conveyor belt, the little
dividers.
Yeah,
they wind me up, those dividers. Sorry, I said a complete tangent, but I, for some reason, it's my own psychosis. But I get so annoyed if I'm in a supermarket. I've got my shopping. I'm just about to get served, and you can always see there are certain people who stand behind you, getting edgy, itchy, worried that I'm not going to put the divider down to separate my shopping from theirs. It's like they're terrified that I'm somehow going to deliberately pay for their shopping.
Sneaking their onion.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't get an onion, I'll have that. And it's just, but what annoys me is it's not so much that, obviously it's a practical thing, it's the fact that they get a little bit edgy. You can actually see, certainly kind of, dare I say it, certain breed of woman and a certain breed of fella will just get a little bit itchy, a little bit edgy, and they just look at you, you can just see them sweating, especially if they can't read.
I just lean over and do it myself.
Well, I know, but it's the thing is that it's like they almost feel that they ought to wait for me to do it, as though somehow it's my obligation. And it just annoys, for some reason, I know it's ludicrous, but it really annoys me. And I actually deliberately don't put the divider down just to see them sweat.
I like the way that they're actually quite well made. There's some that are brass with like a felt bottom.
Yeah.
Like you really care. Like a twig would do, wouldn't it?
Exactly. You know what I mean? But I just leave a slight gap. And then when it gets to when the woman's putting it through the till or the guy, I just say, that's my stuff.
Do you ever look at other people shopping and go, oh, I should have got that?
Often.
God, yeah. That's annoying.
I'll tell you what it is, it's the same thing, and again, it's my psychosis. When people, if you're on a bus or a train, and we're pulling into the stop, but there's a good, you know, kind of 35 seconds before we're actually going to come to a halt, they leap up,
they get
and they're
first,
straight by the door.
Yeah.
Like, but it's this fear that something, they're going to miss out. Oh my God, what if I fell over now and broke my ankle? I'd never get out.
To be fair, I've never had that commuter's worry. I've never commuted, but every second counts, doesn't it? Because you miss a train, it can make a difference of half an hour. So that's why commuters literally run to get their connections.
But the thing is that with a bus,
you know,
this often you'll be people who are sat right next to the exit will get up and stand up for a while waiting to get out. It just, again, I'm not saying it's not, it makes perfect sense to them.
When you've got a day,
it's my psychosis.
They're going to be mowed down in the streets.
They will just be a few of them.
You're going to be in a lovely Chrysler.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, I will be going straight through a branch of Waitrose.
Yeah.
Taking people out in the.
So we do not condone going through Waitrose in a car.
In a car.
Now Chang and Ang, they're in the bath. They're washing their own bits. They've got one of those dividers, right? They go, "Well, that's definitely yours. I marked mine. That's definitely mine.
What?
Don't wash that, Chang. I wouldn't, Ang. I wouldn't wash that. Right. So what are they doing? They're in the bath. Carry on with the story.
That's about it, really. I mean, Jesus. that's the fact that people...
So, two people, two little Oriental fellas, joined in the hip, had a bath.
No.
That's your story.
No, they didn't have a bath. They sort of, everybody, they must have done some sort of research, right?
Who?
Chang and Ang, right? And they said, well, what do people want to see?
Isn't that Bay City Rollers song?
But it's an idea that people have queued up, they've paid their money, they're in a tent, they're going, well, I hear they're going to have a bath, they're going to have a bath. Two Siamese people have a bath. How would they possibly do it? Well, I've heard they get into a bath.
But that's what they wanted to see them nude and where the join was.
No.
More than how do you get in the bath?
I don't know, they just, that's what they picked. They said, what would be good to see, what do you want to see them do?
Having a bath.
How'd you get into trousers? Actually,
this is all part of it, isn't it? That's why they picked having a bath.
This is all part of it! Well, then once we get dressed afterwards.
Yeah.
Who was the best out of Chang and Ang? Who was your favourite?
They both look the same, to be honest.
There's a surprise! One was a short ginger woman. Oh, dear.
Is there anything, what would be better than having a bath for you when you'd seen them? What would sort of make you go, oh, I wonder?
One of them pulling and the other one going home alone.
Yeah.
I go, look, she's definitely up for it. I'm taking her home. I go, oh, God, what am I going to do? Can I watch? Definitely not. Definitely not. Look, you go to bed. I want to wine and dine her.
But if he's got her back to their place and they're going at it, Hammer and Tongs. But are you saying one of them?
No, Hammer and Tongs were their cousins.
Right.
They lived miles away.
Yeah. If one of them gets knackered, can the other one take over?
God! I think we play a record.
That annoys me.
What?
That sort of being at it all night.
What do you mean?
Let's put a song and I'll come back.
What
to
do you
it.
Mean?
The controversial cheeky freak of the week, where Carl finds a human being with some sort of congenital or you know, imposed deformity, or you know. So and we talk about that in a wry way. Do you think that's big and clever?
No, but that's just it. It's never about taking the mickey out of someone, right? It's to make you think.
I'll tell you what isn't big and clever.
How lucky you are.
A dwarf with learning difficulties.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
we'll explain it to you. Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, He Wants You.
Brilliant. Yeah. So, Carl, off you go.
Well, we're not gonna do, Freak of the Week here.
Okay. Right?
Because we've done quite a bit of that in the last 20 minutes, right?
We've OD'd on freaks, you think?
Yeah.
Sure.
We'll just shift it a little bit.
Okay.
And I don't, like I keep saying, don't want people to be thinking we're sort of taking the mick out of anyone.
No.
Right? Because we're not about that. I feel that, like, I can do a little bit of it because I work with you, Steve.
Yeah. Right? Sure.
It gives me that right.
It's like a care worker. Yeah, I understand.
Well, it's like that thing of, you can't be homophobic because I've got a couple of gay mates and
sure,
stuff.
Sure.
I think it sort of gives me that edge.
Yeah.
Right? So
you're not freakophobic because you work with Steve?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. So, yeah.
Okay.
Well, by that token, I should be able to sort of slag off, you know, the mentally ill.
What's or
at least mentally handicapped.
Now, there's a term you don't hear very often. In 2003,
the mentally handicapped.
Isn't that what it was? Oh, I don't know where to start.
But I'd like to
apologise for the Lady Diana stuff, the term mentally handicapped, and any inadvertent racism that we may have done.
What's
whatever.
The actual term then? Is it retarded?
Right, are we having Cheeky Freak of the Week?
Do you want to do it?
What time have you got to show off?
Could do with shooting off sort of soonish.
Okay.
To be honest.
This is not radio. Have you ever heard that on a radio show?
No,
Chris Tarrant going, I can't shoot off right now.
I couldn't
get a later train.
I know! Why didn't you get a later train?
There isn't
a later train. So I couldn't get to Cornwall tonight if I had to. If I had to finish this show, I couldn't possibly get to Cornwall.
Rubbish. Of course there's a later train.
Oh, I've booked it now anyway.
Right, well, that's the point, isn't it? Yeah. You're not fully
Whatever. I don't think the show's lost anything. I think we've still had the, you know, Freak of the Week's coming up now.
Oh, cheeky Freak of the Week.
Right, well, we've had some, interesting things we've been looking at. This week, it's about the strangest couple that ever got married.
And we've had two sets of chimps, yeah. So it's stranger than that. Oh, it's not Dale Winton and Mel McAndrew,
it's not your parents, is it?
Well, we're going back again to about, I think this is about 19,
something like that.
1940.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
Strangest couple, a fella, right? He had skin of a lizard.
He had the skin of a lizard, okay.
And the woman
which
he married.
Which he used as a condom.
The woman who we married, airiest woman ever.
Right.
And that was their act. They used to tour the world, and they'd say, you know, it's like, you know, a couple who've met, they're having a great life. Let's get them out on stage, here they are. And they'd,
what do you mean he had a skin of a lizard, first of all?
That's what it said, he had some sort of, some illness.
So he was called Lizard Man, and you liked that because it was a good description.
I thought that's good.
I'm here. I'm here. Hello, we've booked a table for two. Who are you meeting? I'm meeting Lizard Man. Oh, he's over there.
Yeah.
You know who he is, right?
Yeah.
I'm meeting the hairiest woman in the world. She's over there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what did they do for their act?
Now, bear in mind that we had some Siamese twins last week, and their act was having a bath.
Yeah.
So I hope it's an improvement on that.
What did Lizard Man? He came out and ate some flies, did he?
I don't really know. I just think they stood there and that.
Yeah, when you read this and it goes the most interesting fact ever, Lizard Man, and you go, that's enough.
Yeah,
I can extrapolate from that.
But straight away I start thinking, right, I wonder if they got the wedding photos. And then, like, it said that they had a kid.
Oh, what would that be like?
Exactly, it'd be like
an ostrich, wouldn't it? It would sort of like...
That's what I was thinking.
What did you think it would come out like, the baby?
I didn't think what that looked like, I just was thinking, oh, parents' evening.
You wouldn't want him coming up to the school, would you?
Little Johnny, who starts off relatively normal, he's quite good at, you know, he's good at nature,
yeah.
Isn't he? His mum and dad come into the room and they'd be looking around, wouldn't they?
Well, it's always like that thing at school when, like, you find out your mate's mum and dad are really old.
Right,
have
sure.
You ever seen that?
Yeah.
When you go, your gran and granddad bought you?
Yeah.
And you go, oh.
It is weird.
What's that we're talking about? He calls him mum. What was that? Oh, sorry.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and no, that's always strange. If you had Godzilla and King Kong as your parents,
and they're always fighting,
and you know, like you say, if you're in a school play or something, you wouldn't tell them, would you? You wouldn't want him coming up with a video camera.
He didn't tell his parents he was in the when we were.
Well, exactly.
You did Little Donkey, and you didn't tell your dad, did you? And he came along and videoed it.
Yeah. Kept it quiet. Don't want him to know anything.
But you didn't. What was it? It was meant to be playing. You had a little drum, didn't you?
Yeah, I was doing. I had a little drum. I think it was meant to be playing We Three Kings.
Yeah.
But he started doing Little Donkey and I thought I can add a touch to this.
Sure, you improvised.
Started playing along.
It was like the first remix, wasn't it?
It went down well. But yeah, that's all I was thinking with the Freak of the Week this week. That's what I'm saying about Freak of the Week. It's to get people thinking. Right? Thinking how lucky they are. That, you know, they don't have to
comb their face. What are you talking about? What do you mean, Freak of the Week is to let people know how lucky they are?
Just...
What about the little freak you're talking about? What are they thinking? They're going, oh, he's talking about me. I'm a little hairy lizard man on a stick.
Pop in, give us a call. That's what I'd like to do on a TV programme. That's what I want to do. I want to go and, like, meet these people and say, right, let's just go shopping, let's... You know, we'll film what your normal day's like.
Yeah.
Let's pop out. Nip into Sainsbury's or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, buy a comb.
Park right up close to it.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. So what you're saying is you just want to get a little message out there, which is that there's always someone worse off than you.
Well, there's proof of that in this room. You know what I mean?
Well, I just think it's a shambles. I've asked for Cheeky Freak of the Week, and it appears that Carl's not ready. He's not prepared.
No, I can sort of remember it. It's just I like to have
contempt for the listener.
You just had a whole bunch of adverts and placebo in order to get ready.
We're having a chat.
Do you want to sort yourself out in future?
Yeah. This is what we were chatting about. Someone emailed in about they watched the £200 tumour thing and when it was removed, it was carried away in a wheelbarrow, right? Carl said, what, even when she had it removed, she still carried it round in a wheelbarrow. And he went, I thought it's sort of like she'd got become attached to it. you definitely are my favourite thing in the world. It's great. Look at the way he's looking back.
But I think they're all the same. The people, I mean, I've had more emails about people saying I watched the £200 tumour.
And I shaved me arse.
Than anything else. When we ask questions about science,
we talk,
nothing. Science.
High concept, we talk about political issues.
One person emailed in, they said, I tuned into the £200 tumour documentary. It looked disgusting, I couldn't watch for long. What were you expecting?
Yeah.
That it might sing and dance? Do a little show for you?
These are really your listeners, Carl, now. I think you know what I mean? You find your niche, you attract your... I think me and Steve are pretty much just here.
I think the people that we had in the early days, Rick, they've long since abandoned us. They jumped ship.
They've got jobs. They're out now. They've been released.
Exactly.
Yeah, they're getting their life back together.
Carl, what's the situation with Cheeky Freak?
I've got like a couple of bits. Like I say, I haven't got the in-depth stuff that I normally.
Oh no, because usually it's you know, it's pretty scientific. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Do the jingle. We've come up with a new one, haven't we?
The Freak. Say chic.
Cheeky Freak of the Week.
Right. Well, couple of bits. I don't know which one to use as the main feature for this week.
It's that good, is it?
Well, there's been another one born.
What?
Little kid.
You go on.
Four eyes.
Insult. Just a guy who wears glasses. Come on.
Four eyes. Two noses. Two mouths. That's weird.
This bloke, did he also have two heads, two bodies? Sort of born, sort of slightly separately.
He wasn't stood next to a mirror.
No, no. It's weird, that, isn't it?
That's all you've got,
is it? I love that! That's weird, that. Imagine if the doctor said that. Well, Mrs. Parks, kid's got four eyes and two noses, weird, isn't it? Any clues? Yeah. Any clues?
So, well, that's it.
That's it.
That's all the information.
Well, I'll tell you what, that should be the main one. Okay, no,
but,
I'll answer
you. But like I say, what's the idea of this feature? What do I say all the time?
Dunno.
I always say, think about it. Think about what that would be like.
Okay.
What? Giving birth to him?
No. I think it's a girl. Being like her. Two mouths. Four eyes. What would that be like? Mad, innit?
I don't know what this feature is.
I don't know why. Is there another one? Is that you said?
I mean, two. I hope everyone took the opportunity there during that silence to just think about what it would be like. I know I was.
could she talk with a mouthful?
What
is that allowed?
Because she's got two mouths.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would that be all right in her house?
She'd be eating.
Yeah, she could talk with one mouth and eat with the other.
Right,
I suppose.
Well, listen, the main one, right? You've thought about that. That's good. The main cheeky freak of the week. I haven't got all the details. Smallest person ever. Right. Well, how big would you say that is?
Carl is now sort of like holding his hands up like a fisherman, long ways. That's about 1 foot.
Right. Smallest man in the world. I printed the thing off and I can't find it. There's a little picture of him. Right. The odd thing was.
But why have you asked me how did it say, or was it a picture of him?
I didn't really read it.
Of course you didn't.
Jesus.
I just saw it and thought, oh, that's.
What
that,
you?
That,
try, that, try that, assumed it was natural size.
No, it was that big.
But what do you mean it was that big?
Little fella, like that.
But why are you doing that? What? It was a page with a little fella. How do you know that was natural size?
No, it was, because it said it's world's smallest man. And the funny thing is, I've read the first line, I always read the first line, it said world's
well
smallest
done,
man.
Well done.
The weird thing is, it's got an head like a light bulb. The shape of it, apparently. I don't know if that's got anything to do with his shape and size.
Oh, but, God.
That big.
His name's Mr. Watts.
And the annoying thing is, what got me is, if you're that big,
yeah,
right, don't have your picture taken next to a fruit bowl.
Why was he having his photo taken next to a fruit bowl?
Don't know. Whoever the photographer was, obviously having a bit of a laugh.
Yeah.
At his expense. Because you would just stand in the middle of nowhere, you'd look normal and that, but he was stood there, just leaning on an apple.
Leaning on an apple?
What is this? In what world do you have it?
This was on the internet.
Leaning on an apple? Was it Tom Thumb? What is this? Are you sure it wasn't that some sort of sci-fi show they're advertising?
No, it was
leaning on it. Can you just lean on the apple? Just lean on the apple there. Do me a favour, will you stand next to my chihuahua? You're not taking the piss, are you? No, not at all, no. Would you mind leaning on this matchbox?
Yeah.
Leaning on an apple. And that's what, so he just said he's the world's smallest man, leaning on an apple.
Smallest man, said about his head being like a light bulb, I don't know what that meant. And I just thought, right, that'll do, that's that sort of cheeky freak of the week done. I think that was on, like, Monday, right? I found that, I thought that's done. Printed it off, forgot to get it off the photocopier. Someone's nicked it.
Play a record.
That you got to-
You know, it's just- Steve.
No, can I just say that, Carl, please, if I say, let's have Cheeky Freak of the Week, and you haven't done your research, you haven't got the information, just tell us you can't do it. But don't lead us on.
Don't say this on radio. Hold your hand up to me and go, how tall is that?
It's nothing.
That's radio.
It's nothing.
I think it was that big because he was leaning on an apple.
It's not enough information.
But, imagine Trevor McDonald coming on, going, some news, some stuff, how big's that? How big do you think that is?
Yeah.
Because there was a fella, yeah, coming up after Chris Tarrant. Play record.
I'm angry. I'm actually angry.
What would you, what could you, if I said, right, quick, you've got to come up with top five things, what would it be?
I'm into weird stuff, but it seems a bit tight to stick them in a list.
What, like what?
Well, like, you know, sort of freaky people and that. I've got that freak book. But I don't know if they'd be happy if I called one of them and said, good news, you're at number one, because you've got four legs or whatever. I don't know. Do you know what I mean?
Okay, then, this is the exclusive Ricky Gervais guide to Shortlist magazine, Carl Pilkington Top 5 Freaks, in at number 5.
So you've got to work backwards, haven't you? I've got to know what my number one is.
I think you do work backwards.
Five. Probably, Something not too good at number five, but it's still interesting. Lighthouse Man.
Who's that?
Lighthouse Man. What's Lighthouse Man?
It's a fella with a hole in his head. And he, what he does, rather than moan about it, sticks a candle in it.
Shut up. What are you talking about?
Sticks a candle in it.
What are you talking about? Where is the hole?
I bet he didn't call himself Lighthouse Man, did he?
Well, I don't know. It's just what he got nicknamed. Because he had this hole. Doctors were like, there's nothing we can do. Can't fill it. So what can I do with it? And it was of the days when there was no electric and that. You had to walk about with a candle. Right. So hang on a minute.
I'm going to have both
hands. Got a little candle holder here. Yeah. Stuck a candle in it. And he just got nicknamed the Lighthouse Man. So again, it's not that amazing, but I like the way he was sort of energy efficient.
Didn't he have, like, wax dripping on his head?
No, because it all went into the hole. So what? In a way, it was filled in.
What do you mean? It wasn't a hole, though. It was a dip, surely.
No, a big hole.
Yeah, but not a hole through the skull with wax dripping on the brain.
No, just a really big hole in his head, but it had skin.
Like a golf hole.
Yeah, I suppose a golf hole's a good way of looking
perfect
at
for
it.
A candle, basically. Yeah. And then the drippage went into the
hole. Yeah. Candle sort of stood up straight.
Yeah.
So was it in his forehead?
No, on the very top of his head.
That's perfect. You don't want it in the forehead, Steve. You'd have to walk back with your neck
ridiculous.
Crick.
So he was like a kind of human jack-o'-lantern.
Yeah. He's a lighthouse man. What is it, Steve? What better description do you need than the lighthouse man?
So yeah, he's probably at number five.
Wow, that's at number five, Steve.
Number four.
What about Pig-Faced Woman of Manchester Square?
Again. You're getting what it says in the tin there, aren't you?
Mm.
Now, Pig-Faced Woman of Manchester Square, is that someone you knew growing up?
No, it's a square in London.
Yeah,
right.
And it's just this woman who had a face like a pig. And the rumour was that it wasn't a woman. Someone said it was a pet bear and they'd shaved it.
Was this someone you saw? No, this is going back.
This is years and years ago.
Yeah.
When there was loads of like weird looking people. I mean, the fact that it's Pig-Faced Woman of Manchester Square says that there might have been one in
Piccadilly Circus.
Whatever. So there was a lot more of them knocking about back then.
Let's assume that it was a woman, and the first one, you know, the lighthouse fellow, he's a human. Do you think people would object because of their disfigurement, deformity, like being called freaks, do you think?
Well, it gave them a purpose back then. See, if you were a freak years ago, there was work for you. You'd have these circus things.
Mm.
Now, if you've got a funny head, you're on the dole. They don't do these sideshows.
All working with Ricky Gervais and Stephen Merchant on the world's number one audiobook. Great. Number three?
What about Elephant Man?
Right.
Stick him at number three. He's
number three?
He's surely the most famous freak ever to have lived, isn't he?
He's the one who got me into it.
Right, yeah, sure, he's sort of entry-level freak.
Yeah.
A gateway freak.
Everyone is aware of him.
Mm.
If the Elephant Man still existed, right, and you got the opportunity to meet him, and you walked in, a couple of questions. One, what would your first reaction be? And two, what would you say to him? What would your first question be?
How would I react? Well, I've sort of seen him enough now that it wouldn't shock me.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't even think I'd flinch.
Okay.
I mean, like I said, when I first saw you, that was a bit weird. Mm. But now, look, I can look at you, I don't double take or anything. What would I say to him, though? I'd probably say, where do you get that hat to fit you? He always had that on. Where do you get that from?
That sort of flat cap that he's got.
Yeah. Yeah, that one, really. So,
very stylish.
So, yeah, I'd have him. So he's at number three.
Right. Elephant Man, number three. I can't wait for two and one. Right, OK, number two.
Well, I know
two.
What my number one is. It's just number two now. I don't know his name, but there's a fella knocking about. Well, I don't think he's around anymore. But he had, like, a normal body looking at him. You'd go, what's up with him? He's not a freak. Takes his undies off. He's got two knobs.
Right.
Wow. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, there's nowhere to start.
Do you think he
uses them alternately? Like, I have a wee out of this one, I have a wee out of that one. Or does he just, like, spread the load so he's weeing out of both?
I don't think he knows.
What do you mean he doesn't know?
Like a lucky dip. When he goes to a urinal, he can have a little bet with himself. He's just like, I don't know what's going to happen here.
So do you reckon he holds them
both
out?
Holds them definitely.
So he takes his trousers down, because, I mean, you know...
He can't use a Y front.
Right.
Need more like a W front.
Yeah. So he pops his kegs down, there.
I don't think it's that much of a problem. It's not like,
well, I don't know.
I'd prefer that than Elephant Man's head.
Well, of course you would.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
What if you had Elephant Man's knob?
Yeah, but it didn't work like that, did it? That's the thing. They said he had the body of an elephant, but that's the only thing that wasn't of an elephant standard. His knob was normal. Whereas with this fella, it's the other way around. Everything normal. Took the pants off. Oh, well, what's going on here?
But why would you ever take his pants off?
No, well, I wouldn't. I'm just saying if...
But why, I don't know why you'd be in a situation with this man with two knobs standing there with his pants on and you go pop your pants off. You're not a doctor.
No, say if I'm waiting in a cubicle,
yeah,
and he's there.
For what?
Sure, you're waiting in a cubicle
I'm waiting to have a wee at a cubicle. He's taking
toilet.
Two urinals up and going, hang on, you don't need them both, do you? He goes, well, actually, look at this.
Right.
He's got two knobs.
See, I didn't see him at two urinals. I saw him at one, maybe them pointing inwards.
If you had that, and the first time that you met Suzanne, would you mention that straight up?
Would you say, right, before this goes any further, I've got something to show you?
Well, tell me exactly what you would say. All right, Carl, I can't wait to go back to your place.
Oh, maybe we should end up sort of like a boyfriend and girlfriend and live together for the rest of our lives. You had normal head then, didn't you?
I had the same head, yeah.
Yeah, but it had, like, hair in coming out of it, didn't it?
And sort of like... Yeah, but she also had a smaller arse back then as well, so I think we've both been dumb.
If you want to hear more of this kind of intellectual discussion, then download our audios. Anyway, we need to get to number one.
Yeah, number one.
Okay, it is.
It's Pillow Man.
Oh, yeah.
Pillow Man. Okay, now explain for those that don't know who he was.
He's a fella with no arms and legs, mm-hmm. Just a head. And a little body. Nickname Pillow Man. Mm. What else do you need to know?
Well, why is he your favourite?
Just because he's amazing. Just the way he just got on with his life. He used to light a cig, just using his lips and his tongue and that.
Oh, I've seen this.
Not fully lit. He'd buy like Roll Your Own.
Yeah, it's in the film Freaks, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he
had a shave as well.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
How did he have a shave?
He used to do it. He used to get it in his mouth, and I don't know.
Jesus,
it's amazing. Did he have a knob?
I think he did because he had some kids.
What?
Yeah, he had kids. He was an all right looking fella. He wasn't. He wasn't odd looking.
Sorry.
No, he's Ed. He looked like Samuel L. Jackson. Imagine him with no arms and legs.
Right, that's odd, though, isn't it? Really?
It's weird, but you've got to give it to him. You know, I mean, he's there rolling his own. He's pretty cool looking.
I just want to say to people, it's not. You say it looks cool. You know, with no arms and no legs to smoke, but don't forget that smoking can stunt your growth.
Yeah. But, yeah, remember, he was on, like, this circus freak show thing with,
yeah,
like, a bearded woman.
Yeah.
Right? Which isn't really a freak, is it? She's gonna have a shave. Have a shave, you're not a freak anymore.
Yeah.
A bearded woman. Compared to a fellow who's got no arms and legs, a bearded woman, you're get out! But there was like a fella with no bottom half to his body, called Johnny Eck, was his name. So, you know, when you're knocking about with that crowd, you're going to get a bit. You're going to get a bit. So, yeah, he had kids and they were all normal kids. They had all the limbs.
And did his wife had arms and legs?
Never saw his wife.
Never saw his wife.
I think he's...
He was probably ashamed of her. She was a bit of a freak.
For someone like him, you'd think he'd just give up, wouldn't you? You think, forget it. What sort of life is it?
Yeah.
I'm like a Mexican jumping bean. It's not worth living. But he just got on with it. To have a shave, I don't even bother having a shave some days.
No. Nor did the bearded lady. Lazy fucking bitch.
So that's why I've put him at my number one position. It's just amazing, isn't it? The human. You know, how you know, whatever you dealt, some people just get on with it.
Yeah.
So yeah, the Pillow Man. Or draft excluder, as I prefer to call him.
There you go!
Oh. I never go to the doctors unless it's really
bad. That is sensible.
Bad.
That is very good advice.
No.
That's brilliant advice
for
anyone
though.
Listening. Never go to the doctors.
Unless it's really bad.
But that's why a lot of people, you know, die, because they don't want to bother the doctor, or they're mildly embarrassed, or they don't know symptoms, bad symptoms. Go to the doctor if you're not sure about something. Like, you were terrified to go and have your prostate.
Still not doing it.
Why not?
I wish you wouldn't talk about it, because now Suzanne will listen to this And she'll go, oh yeah, you haven't been, and start dragging it up again.
But why are you worried about a qualified doctor?
I don't know what they're doing up there.
What, they
what
just
pop- What year are we in?
They what are you talking about? They pop their finger up.
That's what I mean, though.
Why?
Why are they still using the index finger?
What, would you prefer the forefinger or the thumb, would
no.
you?
No, what I mean is, we've got...
Or a thumb on a stick, some kind of thumb on a stick. You,
yeah, would you prefer it to
a mechanical thumb, a robot thumb.
Why isn't it just a little camera?
Well, they put the camera up if they initially discover something.
But just put the camera up straight away. If
no, they don't need to. They pop the finger up, feel that the prostate isn't swollen, wiggle it around a little bit, up your back passage. What are you worried about?
I don't think they need to do
are
that.
Are you embarrassed? Are you embarrassed about being in a room with your trousers around your ankles and a little fella's popping
a
his...
little bit, yeah.
Why?
And the other thing is, it's not just that, is it? So you go in there, they check your heart out and that, which to me is the most important thing, because that's what keeps you going, isn't it?
Yeah! Right?
You've got to go there. You're sat on the bus, stressing out, thinking, oh, in less than half an hour, I'm going to have a finger up the arse, right?
What is the problem,
and they go
though?
In, they check your heart, they probably check your testicles and that.
What's up with that? They check your testicles, yeah? That's
yeah, but it's all building, and you've sat there going, oh, soon that'll be happening.
Yeah.
And that's what puts me off.
So if they just came round when you're asleep, Suzanne just let them in and goes, he's over there, right? Yeah. And they crept up and went, bang, you go, what are you doing?
I just don't understand why they don't teach you how to do it yourself.
How can they? How can they teach? Imagine you squatting in a corner with one hand on your bollocks and the other finger up the arse going, it seems to be all right.
Carl, you don't understand the phrase, a stitch in time saves nine. I don't think you should be doing any kind of invasive medical research in your own human body.
But then...
Who knows what trouldyou're going to cause?
No, but then at least...
You would get stuck.
Yeah.
You would get stuck.
Susanna come out, your fist would be up your own arse. Woke up at 9:55 a.m. Soon as I woke up, I looked at Suzanne and she looked at me. I said, did I tell you about...
I just think him opening his eyes and looking at
him. Okay, all right. Okay, so he opens his eyes, he looks at Suzanne, she looks at him. What question, Rick, do you think he immediately asks his girlfriend?
Go on.
What question do you think? Have a quick guess.
Am I dreaming?
I woke up, I said to my girlfriend, did I tell you about- I woke up, I looked at Suzanne, she looked at me, I said, did I tell you about the immune system? Did I tell you about the immune system? Suzanne started laughing, I said, it's amazing. She said, not now. Springing into action, he zips up, his eyes are like... Did I tell you about the immune system? Oh, shut up, Carl. I'll put the kettle on.
Oh, God! Oh, fucking hell!
More, revelation. We were talking about it last week, but Carl brought it up again. Just now. Didn't want to go to the doctors. Didn't want to have a full sort of body checkup that may save his life, because he saw on the website they do... A test where they have to insert a finger in his ass.
Well, don't tell me about it.
Why?
Don't put it on the website. Just put, we look at your heart.
Yeah.
We check your blood pressure out.
Yeah.
And then they could just do it quickly. Could just sort of say, right.
How can they do it quickly?
No, but what I'm saying is, it's worse, isn't it? Going in there, knowing that, I mean, they've got it on the website. So you're on the journey on the bus thinking, in about 20 minutes, I'm going to have a finger up my arse.
But, they're doctors.
Yeah, but just
they're not doing it for a laugh. They're not filming it with a two-way screen. They're not putting on boxing gloves so it hurts more. They're up. Oh, is the prostate all right? Out again.
I'm just saying, in the day, the sort of.
Do you think they're in the pub going, here he comes? It's Pilkington. I have my finger up his arse.
Do they allow ladies to do that? Do they allow female doctors to do it?
Of course they do. They're doctors.
No, that's worse.
Though. You're sounding like him.
No, I'm just interested because you know, do they allow female doctors to do the finger up the arse thing?
Well, of course they do! They're doctors! Forget the female and male, they are doctors!
Right, do you know any female doctors to do that? But what I mean is, isn't it a bit like if you're being searched at an airport, you know, and you're a woman, they send in a woman person to search you. They don't send in a bloke to do it. Is that the same thing?
Yeah, they probably trust someone who's gone through 6 years medical college not to be taking the piss as opposed to a fat security guard who couldn't get anything else. Do you know what I mean?
What are you talking about? There's doctors all the time coming out in the papers, oh, they gave them this so they could look at their boobs or whatever, or, you know, it's all well, you're always hearing stuff about dodgy doctors.
But what I'm saying is, the reason why they do that security, because there's lots of security people and they can, you know, for your own, you know, for the, you know, your own modesty, there's a female one to search females and a male one to search males, and that's fine. But there's not like 4 or 5 GPs to choose from, and you go in there and you go, is it your arse and testicles? Do you want a bloke or you accept it.
What about long fingernails?
They don't have long fingers. What do you think this female GP looks like? She's sitting behind the desk like Cruella de Vil with cleavage and long red false nails going, hello love, bend over, this may hurt a little bit. There's gloves and Vaseline. I don't believe what, there's two of you now in the room. Carl, they're doctors. What would you rather do than put the hand down your throat and round your alimentary canal to feel your ass? It's a quicker way in.
You seem to know not about these doctors and stuff, fingers up people's asses. You're a very well-informed gentleman. What about this sort of thing?
say if they did find something.
Yeah.
Would you then have to get, like, a second opinion, so someone else's finger?
Well, no. They test it to see if there's anything suspicious. That it's usually a swollen prostate, which can be anything. So they, you know, they catch it early, and that's it. They feel up there.
But if you want a second opinion, then the same doctor will just stick a thumb up and have a feel around there. So it always works in the same way.
Yeah.
Well, if there's a doctor who can, I don't know, put me at ease. I mean, surely there's another way around it. I don't believe that. I mean, what is this? 60 million people or something in the world, isn't there? 60 billion or something?
Well,
6 billion, something.
Yes, you got it. Right. You hit it. Well done.
That's good work.
Right, so yeah, this 6 billion, did I say?
Yeah, what's 6 billion then?
Loads, isn't it?
Yeah, but.
So if you want a doctor to phone up to assure you that the finger at the bum thing's not painful and that it's necessary and
just that
it's not
necessary, really. It's just that it's not an easy way round.
Alright, what's the phone number here?
It's, changed, haven't they?
Oh, for
you're the producer!
Hang on, here it is. 0871 222 1049, and I think you select option 1. It tells you, anyway, what to do.
Please, if you're a GP, or you've, you know, even if you've completed medical, I mean, we want a qualified doctor, really. Anything else is not good enough for Carl Pilkington. Just to we'd love to talk, you can ask him all the other questions, because, you know, Carl, as I said last week, he doesn't feel his own testicles because he doesn't like the feel.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'd like a doctor to explain to him how necessary that is.
And this is truthful as well. I've got a very slight pain around the genital area at the moment, and I think it might be some kind of groin strain, but I'm a little bit anxious, not entirely sure.
Yeah,
what it is,
so. You've been with me twice when I've gone along to get him checked.
Yeah.
I go, oh, what's that?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's terrible. I mean, but, you know, it's usually, I think you're in a pretty low risk, Eric, aren't you?
I'd hope so.
You're coming out of the 20s. I think it's I think testicular sort of, I shouldn't be doing this, I'm not qualified.
No.
All they said was to me, sort of like, it's 20s and 50s.
Mine,
so, like, we're into it.
Mine sort of felt like they dropped a bit the other week when I was on holiday. I don't know if that's, like, when you're relaxing or wearing shorts a lot.
How far? If it's 2 foot, it's too far.
I was having problems walking.
What do you mean?
Why? No, it was just a bit sort of a bit. I had shorts on all day. I'm happy and walking about on the beach, and what have you?
Mm.
And then at the night, when I put some long trousers on, I was sort of walking like
they probably like stretch a little bit sometimes. I told you when I was about 18, I was scared. I went to the doctor. I felt a pain, right? And because I was doing biology, I thought I'd show off. This doctor said, "I've got a pain. I think it feels like it starts in the epididymis and goes up to through the urethra." Either, and he went,
"Finger up the arse."
He said, "Your jeans are too tight. They're squashing your balls."
Carl, we're often accused of bullying you. This is a recurring thing, isn't it? That we bully you, but. Both of us, and Ricky in particular, is always concerned about your well-being, particularly in Alaska, if you recall.
You are not going to be eaten by a polar bear. But when you had your medical, I found out that you didn't let them test your prostate, did you?
No. No. But that's...
Why not? In the UK alone, more people die every year from prostate cancer than being savaged by a polar bear.
It's a bit of a weird time to bring it up when I'm in the middle of nowhere.
It's one of the biggest killers, right? And that's just a simple test. So a doctor pops his finger up your anus and he goes, yep, you're all clear. and that's you relaxed for another year.
I don't understand why you're suddenly caring about this now. I've got little battery left on this phone. I'm wearing the battery out. If something happens, I'm dead.
Right.
He's my best mate. Sue me. I'm worried about him.
Yeah, yeah.
No, but why isn't there ever anything about how's your blood pressure? Or how are your feet? You're in the cold. Are you warm enough? Are you... No, because it was none of that. It was,
yes, I know.
Why don't you get a finger up your arse?
Because often there are no symptoms.
Well, I don't want it done.
I know you don't, but it's good for you. So, can we bring the doctor out, please?
Right, well, this is a waste of time, then.
This is Frank. That's Carl.
Frank, how's it going? You all right? Good to see you.
Is the consultant urologist at St Bart's?
Yeah, St Bart's.
Yeah.
The thing about prostate cancer is you can be perfectly well and yet still have prostate cancer. And one of the ways that we can detect if that may be a problem is a rectal examination.
The thing with feeling...
I don't want a finger up the arse, though.
Wait,
you keep going on about this.
Right.
I've told you time and time again. I mean, I presume there's a lot of ill people knocking around that Frank should be looking at. Instead, he's here debating with you two whether he's going to shove his finger up the arse.
How long would it take if you did it now? If you went... No, wait, how long would it...
15 seconds.
15
That's
seconds.
That's a long time, as far as I'm concerned. What are you looking for?
What we're looking for, OK, it's two things we're looking for. One is the size of the prostate gland. Number two... It's the consistency of it. In other words, what it feels like. It's a quick, simple thing to do.
Carl, can I tell you what's going to happen? It's going to be about 10 seconds. He's going to say, you're all clear. You're going to say, what was the fuss about? And you know you haven't got prostate cancer.
But not today.
There's no better time.
Maybe it's that you and I and the cameras and that are making it a bit intense.
Oh,
maybe
got
if
a private
I went
room.
Privately to
we've
another
got a private room.
Step.
We've got a private room. You may as well check his testicles while you're there.
So what's the... rules, eh? What's... I mean, I know it's an important thing to have done.
Yeah.
But it's just the way they go about it.
Mm.
I've been travelling around the world in dangerous places. They've never cared about me before. Mm. Yet today, they keep going on about having this done.
Men are embarrassed about these things, you know? We're not used to these things. But for the sake of something that really is very quick and painless, we're talking about potentially saving a life. And before you know it, it's done and it's over.
I know, but it's just... I do this
day in, day out.
That's what you do? Seriously, every day?
Yeah,
every day of my working life, that's what I do.
And are you going to move up and get to do something better, or is this your future now, just sticking your finger up a fellow's arse?
It's part of my... It's just part of the job, you know. A lot of time I spend in operating. A lot of time I spend in clinics.
So how many people are you doing a day?
10 to 20, maybe.
And which finger is it? Is it a big one or a little one?
It's the index finger.
Why is that? Why not just a little?
Because the prostate lies a little bit in. Get your hand. You just couldn't do that with your little finger.
So you're going round a corner. You've got to go in and round.
You've got to go in and then slight twist. It's the thought is worse than the actual delivery. Let's put it that way. It's the thought of it.
All right.
And
okay. Let's do it then.
Let's do it. Do you wear gloves?
Oh, sorry. Yes.
Do you know Richard Blackwood?
Yes, the comedian, yes.
Yeah, he had a colonic on telly, never seen again.
I think that's far worse. So, look, rest your foot, pillow. What you need to do is you need to bend your knees up.
Yeah.
You need to pop that arm over there. So, what I'm going to do, I'm just going to get some lubricating gel. I'll just... Right, so what I'm going to do is... If I may, I'm just going to pop your trousers down. Bend your knees up a bit more. Come towards me a bit more. So you're at the edge of the couch. Marvellous, OK? Take a deep breath. Deep breath. And out, OK? And relax, breathe normally. I'm just going to pop a finger in now, OK? Deep breath, well done.
Jesus,
well done.
That's high up. Fucking hell. Right, that's surely enough, isn't it? Right, you're all touching a lung.
Well done. Well done. I'll just your prostate's fine.
Hey!
Well done.
Woo!
Well done.
Oh God!
Well done.
Brilliant.
I don't think it's the sort of thing people pay us.
Guy a subscription for, to be honest.
In HD.
Well done.
Cheers for that, then, Frank. Now you are a doctor, aren't you?
Yep.
He just said to me, because he was shaking, because he said to me, and I quote, he said, oh, he's just whittering to himself, I must remember to eat next time Suzanne's away.
I know.
I know.
I must remember to eat next time Suzanne's away.
No, but you did. I mean, I wonder if I lived on my own if I'd still be about. Because I just neglect myself.
Yeah.
So, I mean, for all I've eaten
this morning, a lot of self-abuse. Is that what you're saying?
I had lasagna last night that I messed up, right?
Why did you mess it up?
Cooked it for too long. It was like a brick. Right? And she called up and said, have you eaten? I went, yeah. She went, was it nice what you have? I said, lasagna. Was it nice? I thought, I don't want her to worry, because she's probably been out and had a good meal with all the work people.
Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't want to say, well, I'm, you know.
And she went, okay, bye, bye. And I go, that can't go. Yeah, I bet he cooked it like a brick.
Yeah.
I bet he threw it away. Anyway, gin and tonic.
Yeah. And I had Scotch pancakes for breakfast. That is all I've had. So I'm starving, I'm shaky. Plus I've got that restless leg syndrome still going on, which I can't get rid of.
What's restless leg syndrome?
I find, if I go to bed, right, my body's tired but my legs aren't.
Are you like Michael Flatley?
You have to get up and do a bit of tap dancing.
Do they just keep going even when you're asleep?
Keep moving about, so I have to get up and stretch them or something. Or I've worked out that if I put a pillar on like the bedpost down at the other end,
yeah.
If I have me legs higher than me heart, it calms it down a bit.
Is this why Suzanne works away so often?
I don't know, it's weird.
To get a decent night's sleep.
I put it down to Smarties and that. It's like a sugar thing. But yeah.
Stop eating them.
Apparently Bob Mortimer's got it as well.
No, he's got arthritis.
Was he?
You told me in the week that you'd mastered moonwalking.
Yeah. Yeah, I can do that.
Is that one of the things you did, like, in the middle of the night?
It's moon sleepwalking.
Yeah, yeah.
He just gets out, he finds himself walking backwards and wakes up and goes, oh God, I'm brilliant at this.
Medical problems then. I've got a couple of things under the banner of, colon then educate me.
Yeah.
We've got, this is interesting, right? Do you know if you have an operation on your brain? Right, what they do is, this is why I'd never go to the doctors. I don't like doctors because this sort of stuff freaks me out, right? They can operate on your brain, and what they do is they put you to sleep first, cut your brain case open.
Your skull, yeah.
Your brain case.
Yeah.
And then wake you up and operate on you. So you're sat there with your head open.
Yeah.
Messing with your brain, and you don't feel anything.
Well, there's no nerve endings, is there, in the brain?
But still, it's not right, is it?
What, you think they do it for fun?
No,
they go on, Reg, wake him up so he looks freaked out.
Is it necessary that you're awake, do you think, or...?
Well, they need the brain active, don't they?
Yeah, but it is. When you're asleep, you're having mad dreams. I had a mad dream the other day.
Go on.
No, I might tell you about it later, but there's no sense to it. But, so your brain still, your brain
still... Where is this conversation?
Yeah, I mean, it'll turn out. I go, no, Carl, I was there, that wasn't a dream.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
But, so, I mean, if I had an operation...
On your brain, heaven forbid.
Well, operation anywhere, I'd like to sort of think, well, I'll have an injection, I'll go asleep, but when I wake up, it'll all be sorted.
Yeah.
The fact that...
Your brain case is open.
Open, and they wake you up and you think, oh, is it all done? They say, well, have a look in the mirror. And you, and your brain...
See, I don't think they do that. I don't think they try and frighten you when you're doing an operation.
Yeah, I don't think that you go about your business and they sort of follow you around, dabbling.
Yeah.
No, but it's almost like they are having a bit of a laugh with you.
Right, well, I'd just like to say now that they don't. Anyone who's going in for an operation on their head, do not ever listen to anything Carl says.
Why have you got to be awake? Because you'll be bored anyway, you'll be sat there.
They give you a telephone directory, look, and they say, look how many Macs are in there. That's the Scottish telephone directory. And, you know, time flies when you're counting that sort of thing.
No, but do you know, like, when you...
What are you telling me? What are you asking me?
I'm just saying how weird it is. It's weird, isn't it? It's like, do you know when you go for a haircut, right? It's a bit embarrassing. Well, I don't anymore, but when you go for a haircut, it used to be... It used to be a bit embarrassing when, like, they'd wet your hair and they'd make you have that sort of... Hitler cut because your hair's wet, and I used to hate it. And I think, do you have to do that? Do you know what I mean?
It's very similar to open skull surgery.
What I'm saying is, it's almost like barbers like to do that to make you look daft and feel daft for a bit. And there's women coming in and out, and you're sat there with a daft haircut.
Yeah.
And this is what that reminds me of.
Do you think they do it in a shop window? This brain operation?
I'm just saying, it's a bit weird.
Why are we doing it in John Lewis's?
Just so more people
I love the idea that that's what doctors are doing. Let's make this guy look a bit stupid.
Yeah.
Open his brain
look
case.
Look at the twatty look with his brain out of his head.
Take a Polaroid, Reg. Take a Polaroid.
Look at him. Look at his face. Right, clock his face when I give him the mirror. Get this on camera.
Put his fake nose and glasses on.
Sorry, did you teach me something then? Was that educational?
I taught you that your brain case can be open when you're awake. And you just sat there, sort of letting them get on with it.
Brilliant, I've learned that, I'll never forget that. Right, go on, anything else?
So, we'll move on to this next one, right, which is brilliant.
Go
dead short story, so. Right, old woman, about 70 years old.
Yeah.
She's normally fit and healthy and stuff, nothing wrong with her, she's having a good life. And, one day, she goes for a check to the doctors.
Yeah.
Just to check herself out, because she's getting on a bit.
Yeah.
Says, take your clothes off and that. So, she does. And, checks her out, says, yeah, you're looking good. Turn round. He said, oh, God. He says, you've got a tumour on your buttock. Right? So, she goes, oh, what, can you do anything to sort it out? So, they go, yeah, we could book you in for an operation. It's best if we remove this. Books her in for an operation. Operation day comes. Strip her down and that, they're all stood round, the doctors, start to operate, it only turns out it's a pork chop that she sat on 5 years earlier and it had stuck to her buttock.
Right, Carl.
I'm serious.
Right, okay, Carl, I'm telling you now, I'm leaving. I'm never doing this show again.
No, I'm serious, honestly.
You're talking, I've never had such You are. Play a record.
I can't believe it.
What do you mean you can't believe it? Stop the record. Right, okay, right, what do you mean you couldn't believe it?
No, when I read it, I said I've got to tell Richard.
This woman had a pork chop stuck to her ass for 5 years, you mental case. Of course she didn't.
This other day.
Yeah.
Oh, what was it now? Listen,
alright, he's got it now.
Go on.
This fella goes to the doctors, right?
Oh, right, okay. Right, if this isn't any way apocryphal, stupid, illogical, impossible, right, you are never, ever speaking again on radio. So make sure this is at least possible. I'll tell you what, I'll even give you improbable, but possible. So if anything that breaks the laws of the universe, or logic, okay, that's all you have to avoid. On you go.
Right, so this fella, right, he goes to the doctors because he's got earache.
Right. Okay, if a chimp's living in his brain,
Go on.
So he's got earache, he's sat in the waiting room and it's all, his ears all bunged up and it's hurting a lot and what have you. So the doctor comes out and he goes, right, and because his ears all bunged up, he doesn't hear it that well, right? So he thinks, it must have been me. Right? So he wanders in.
Keep going.
Anyway.
I'm gonna hate this. I can just feel it in my bones. Steve, I'm gonna let you take over. Okay,
let's hear it.
So the doctor says, sit yourself down there. Right? So he sits himself down. He goes, take your pants off. Right? So he's thinking that's a bit odd. Anyway,
he heard that though.
Apparently he took his tackle off. The doctor, like, did some operation.
What, there in the waiting room?
No, in his office.
In his office, yeah.
What?
So he removed what? His genitals?
Yeah.
In his office?
Why, Carl?
Because he hadn't called him in.
Oh, he's calling the bloke who wanted his testicles taken off, and he didn't hear it. What? So the doctor went out and said, Mr. Jones, who's here to me to whip off your cock and balls, just here and now, right? Bloke comes in, didn't it? It must have been me. So the bloke with the, we wanted his balls taken off didn't say, I think he said me. So he didn't interrupt then. So the bloke goes in, he starts taking his testicles off and he doesn't say, I'm in.
Alright.
What's been going on?
I've been to hospital. I was rushed to hospital, right, emergency and that. Had a, tube put on my knob.
You had a tube put up your knob?
Yeah.
What's the story?
Kidney stones.
Oof.
So, shouldn't really be here, to be honest, doing this. He said rest and that. Climbing them stairs on the way in.
To be quite honest, it doesn't look like you're expending a lot of energy at the moment. It's like at Zookeeper going, that sloth move today. Calm down.
Yeah, but I had to get here. It's been raining.
Yeah.
I had to come up the stairs. I had to carry the computer.
Yeah.
Well, that's not entirely true, because your girlfriend was carrying it. I saw her outside.
Yeah, but I'm just saying.
And then you handed it to me and said, Steve, carry this.
God almighty.
Yeah, I know.
That's already a lie.
Christ almighty. Whinging.
Not whinging.
I'm in show business. I know loads of people that wake up every day with a sore knob, feeling like they've had their kidneys probed, and they you know, they would say they're unconscious. So they don't whinge about it, they get straight back onto it. They, you know, a lot of them on TV now.
Yeah, straight back to hosting game shows.
So, you're rushed to hospital.
So take us through the events, because it does sound quite dramatic. You started feeling a bit of pain, did you, initially?
I felt a bit of pain. I thought, you know, yeah, maybe I've just pulled a muscle or something when I've been wrestling with Ricky and that, because you don't know what damage is being done. So I just think, oh, it'll go in a minute, and then it didn't. It got a bit badder.
It got badder, did it?
So then I was crippled. I was lying on the floor in agony, looking on the internet, looking for a sort of
still
solutions.
Looking at Monkey News.
I just put in like belly ache and stuff, and they were saying it can be loads of different things. What I used to do when I was a kid, I used to always just get a cold ashtray and put that on my belly. And the coldness used to get rid of the badness.
Amazing.
The coldness got rid
of it. Like a witch doctor.
Yeah.
This is like...
A witch doctor who happens to work in a pub.
It's like some sort of 5th century remedy.
Yeah.
Written in mud. Yeah. Coldness doth get away with the badness.
Yeah. Why specifically an ashtray?
Just because they sort of old cold.
They're old cold.
I don't know what this is. I love this idea that he's at the operation and he comes round and they're talking to him and his girlfriend gets a phone call and they say, Mr. Pilkington's maybe complications. He's just talking rubbish. Yeah, she goes, oh good.
Yeah, he's back to his old self. Why specifically an ashtray? Sorry, because it's old cold. I understand it's old cold.
Oh yeah, we understand. Everyone who's done a medical degree understands old cold. But old cold belly madness. If you want to buy that book, old cold belly madness, it's the history of abdominal surgery by Carl Pilkington.
No, it just, you know, if
so,
if
but you put it in the freezer or something first.
You can do if you want, but they're normally cold anyway. Sort of thick glass and that, it holds the cold. But we don't smoke in our house, so I had to use a plate.
Oh, well, that's madness. A plate's not going to work. Famously, a plate doesn't work.
No.
Oh, God, no! So you put a plate on your belly, but that didn't do any...
That didn't work, so called Suzanne and said, oh, I'm in agony here. She said, go to the doctors then.
Good advice.
So...
A lot of people have done that straight away, as opposed to going through the plate... Ashtray.
So he went to hospital and they went to hospital and he said, have you got an ashtray? This is no smoking.
So anyway, so then we get in a cab and what have you, go there. I have an x-ray.
His voice is even more boring than usual,
isn't it?
Extraordinary,
isn't it? Yeah.
Fuck me.
And they put me on a drip and everything. Give me some morphine and stuff. And found out that I had kidney stones. So that's why I was in hospital. And they get them out by... I don't know what's gone on, to be honest.
Come on.
I've got some tube inside me. From my kidney to my bladder. That's helping me stuff get about.
And so there's a little tube up the end of your knob into your...
Yeah, it's not there now. It's high up.
Right.
So it's high up between my kidney and my bladder.
But why didn't you have the thing where they go in the side? You had the choice to...
Because I said to the doctor, I said, I'm not a doctor. I said, what do you think?
He went, stop putting yourself down, Carl. We need you in the operating theatre now.
He just said, you know, I said to him, what should I have done? Because he said, if you want, go home and we'll get you in again or something. Something like that. And I said, no, I might as well have it done properly. Have it done now whilst I'm here.
Sorry, the choice was have it done properly or go home.
It was something like that. He said, there's something you can do. And I said, oh.
Flush it out.
No, because it's too big. It's something like 7 millimetres.
And it's basically because you don't drink enough water.
Yeah. So, anyway, I said, what do you think I should have done? And he said, tube up the knob. And I said, not my favourite one of the choice, but if that's what you think. So he said, yeah, have that. He did me little diagrams, which didn't help. He was like showing.
How big did he draw your knob?
Sort of normal size.
Yeah, was it?
It was all right.
You weren't offended by them.
But he went into detail. It's just, you know, more the tubes and stuff in your bladder and your kidney.
What was your ball bag like? Did he draw that?
He didn't do that bit. He left that bit out.
Okay. Right.
But But he said, we'll just pop that up there. And then that's when Ricky turned up to visit. Came in laughing at me because we were sat there in like me underpants and stockings.
In stockings?
Yeah!
Yeah.
Why were you dressed?
He was there. No, he wasn't in bed. He was sort of out of bed with his little drip, right? He had his little boxer shorts on, just sat there, right? In his pants, right? And he had stockings on.
Yeah, because they stop clots or something. They put them on your legs. It's like, you know, when people have got big veins and they go on a plane.
Right. You said you're not a doctor.
No, but I've seen it, because Suzanne's mum did it, and it was, she put them on ridiculously early, like 3 days before we were going away, and I've never been away before, and everything was, like, over the top, do you know what I mean? She's like, I best put them on. And, so I put them on, and they, like, I don't know what it is, it's something when you're in, when you're under, your blood doesn't move about the same.
Right.
And it can clot up in your leg. So you wear these tight tights.
And I came in to cheer him up, didn't I?
Yeah.
Was that a nice, cheery experience, him coming in?
I had a headache at the time. I think I was a bit stressed out.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's just the man you want at that point.
Yeah.
He reassured you, I imagine.
Well, it's weird how it suddenly all happened quick. It was like, as soon as he came in, it's like they got the finger out. And when I say
not
that,
literally.
I mean
yeah.
Suddenly I was being rushed down to, you know, have me stuff done. And I woke up and there was an Irish woman over me going, are you all right? Are you all right? And I said, oh, it's stinging a bit. She said, I'll give you some more morphine. And I sort of put my head up to have a look at my tackle, because I wanted to see...
if it was still there.
What was attached to it. Do you know what I mean? Because they said something about they might leave some string hanging out of it, so they can pull the tube out.
It makes you talk.
So, I had a look for that. Couldn't see any of that.
Yeah.
But as you put the morphine in, all the muscles in your body go funny. My head just collapsed.
Your head collapsed.
Yeah, I sort of looked up to look at my stuff, but then she said, oh, you just need a little bit of morphine. And she put that in, and I just sort of went, oof. And then they sent me home about 2 hours after.
Oh.
But I'm in agony now, and...
Are you in agony right now as we speak?
Yeah, it's hurting.
Now, are you a man who's had this kind of hospital experience before? Is this your whole first time?
I don't go, do it to hospitals and stuff, because I don't like them messing about. But it does make you think now, do you know what I mean? Like... life and everything. From, I mean, it's weird how it's all happened in the last month, from seeing that bee sort of die.
No, no.
Well, not really.
No, no. This is not a near-death experience.
It is.
You had a routine operation to remove kidney stones because you don't drink enough water.
No, I know, but...
this is not a shark attack.
Yeah, but it's all life-threatening, otherwise you wouldn't have to fill out forms, would you, saying, if everything goes wrong, Suzanne can have the house or whatever. And then you find out more about the body as well, which has been sort of doing me head in a bit. You're more aware of stuff in your body, which I don't like knowing about.
Yeah.
They keep checking your heartbeats and stuff,
mm.
And your blood pressure. I don't like knowing about that. I just like, leave it. It's happening. Don't be messing with it. Stop measuring it.
Stop measuring it!
No, do you know what I mean?
That's the same with a knob.
It's that thing of like, they put that thing
That's
on.
What the anaesthetist was doing when you were under, wasn't it?
Yeah.
He was comparing the diagram to the actual thing.
Oh, God. The fella across the way from me had the same thing as me, but he'd had it a couple of days ago when he was in agony. So that doesn't help when he's saying, oh, I've been to hell and back. Like, don't tell me that.
Sure.
I don't want to know. Just say it was all right and stuff. So it just, the whole thing of a hospital is stressful. Do you know what I mean? They wake you up like every half an hour in the night, saying, how do you feel? It's like, well, what, you know, it's 3:30. What are you doing? I've got to have it done again in a couple of weeks. Because what they've done now, they've popped that straw up, but the stone's still in there because they didn't have the laser team in with them. Blast the stone, and then that time they're probably going to leave a little bit of string out the end. Then they have to go about 3 days later and they pull it out.
I was out the other day, right? A woman came up to me. She said, oh, excuse me, you go to the gym much? So, I was going to lie, but they find out, don't they? They say, where do you go and all that, and how many star jumps can you do? She said, no, what's probably putting you off? She said, the fact that it's hard work. She said, it doesn't need to be hard work. She said, come to my class. She said, what we do on Wednesday nights, breathing classes. Classes teaching you how to breathe. I said, I'm 32, I think I've got the hang of it. She said, no, it's not that, I said, forget it. See, I think the reason there's so many gyms in London is because of
the amount of gay people who are here now. I'm not having a go. I'm not complaining about it. I'm just saying, gay people, they always sort of like to look after themselves, don't they? They're always sort of muscly and that, sort of tight t-shirts and stuff whenever you see them. You know what I mean? I'm not looking out for them. I'm just saying, when I do see them, they're sort of muscly and that. So because there's more of them, more gyms are needed. But then the problem is, the more gyms we have, the less other shops we have, because the space they take up. The other weekend, I just wanted to do some painting and decorating in the flat. Right? Thought, right, I need some brushes and some paint. You wouldn't think that'd be hard to find in London. Yeah, couldn't find anywhere. Couldn't find any sort of hardware shop, DIY shop. Yeah, if they had an urge to do some sit-ups, you know what I mean? I'd be spoilt for choice. I look in some of my girlfriend's magazines, and it's all like, you know, eat this, don't eat that, drink water. The amount of times people are telling me, oh, you don't drink enough water, you. Your dad's like 60-odd, right? I've never seen him have a pint of water, yet they're telling us we should have like 7 pints a day or something. And then they wonder why there's a water drought on. There's a fella on the telly the other week who was saying we only get so many heartbeats in a lifetime, so we shouldn't be wasting them, should we? We shouldn't be running around lifting weights and all that. Now look at the tortoise. Never rushes about, right? Yeah, it lives to be about 250 years old. You know what I mean? When was the last time you heard about a tortoise having a heart attack? Doesn't happen. And they keep coming up with daft ways of sort of keeping fit, don't they? Paintball. You know what I mean? Chucking paint at each other. I don't know where they're getting the paint from.
No. It's something, when I was looking on the web, found something out.
Go on.
It's a story about a woman who had a baby. Who had a baby.
What are you talking about? What?
A woman who had a baby who was having a baby.
It was no clearer when you repeated it.
No! Go! I don't know what to do! I don't know what to do for the common good, right? Pursue this line of inquiry, right? Because I don't know where it's going, or play a record. I'm actually torn. I don't know what to do.
No, I remember seeing it and thinking, I've got to tell Ricky about that. It's brilliant.
What should we do? Should we go with it? It's entering into the abyss. It's opening Pandora's box. It's peeking. It's going down to the cellar.
I've got a couple of questions though.
Go on then.
Well, come down there with me.
Okay,
come down in the cellar with me.
Okay, right, Carl. What? First of all, it was on the way. What do you mean? The baby was what? Had another? Was it? She didn't give birth. The doctor didn't find one of those set of Chinese dolls up her. Russian dolls, whatever they're called.
That's what I pictured it like. Those dolls where you take the head off and there's another one in there that all look the same. But no, the story was there's a woman who's.
No, don't just say it again. That's a headline. That's not a story. There was a woman who had a baby who had a baby. That's not a story. That, imagine handing that in as a thesis to loads of the BMA. There you go. And read that.
That's a children's rhyme.
Yeah. There was a woman who had a baby who had a baby. What do you mean? So the baby, she had a baby, right? Yeah.
And,
That bit's fine. We're okay with that.
That's normal. That's normal.
A woman had a child.
Yeah, totally normal.
She gave birth. Fine.
Yeah.
Next.
Well, I don't know that much more, apart from the fact that the baby's, like, roaming about, and then, 12 months later, she's like, oh.
Interesting. So the gestation period of that baby was actually 3 months more than an adult.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Weird, though, isn't it?
So, was the headline, my baby's 12 months pregnant? What are you talking about, 12 months later it had a- what are you talking about?
Forget it.
No, you haven't even finished the story. That you said, and 12 months later, you didn't even finish the sentence. So what do you mean?
No, I didn't read any more into it because I just saw
you
that
didn't
and I thought,
read it. What?
That's weird. And then I just was thinking, oh, like, imagine the kid at school, at parents' evening.
Go on.
And it's like, well, your kid's pretty good. Now let's have a look at your work, sort of thing. Don't you think that'd be weird?
But what? Did the child have a baby?
Yeah.
Of course it didn't! Play record!
We shouldn't have gone down in the cellar. We should have just left the cellar door closed. I never learn. That's The Zombies and a song called Time of the Season. I've enjoyed that.
What do you think of Zombies, Carl?
It's alright, yeah.
No, not the group, but the Living Dead.
Don't worry about them.
No? Why?
Not about, are they? It's gonna happen.
You don't believe
right,
in
listen,
that?
Listen, right?
You don't believe in zombies?
So,
but you do believe
online.
A baby had a baby?
Yeah.
On you go, on you go.
Are you still saying that didn't happen?
Yes.
Right, well I'll find the thing again, I'll print it off and
well,
then you'll
all
read
I'm
it.
Saying is there's more information that we need.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it always annoys me that when I do get the information, you'll go, yeah, but its name's Sally, you didn't say that, and make out-
No. As if- No, don't make it look like we're over-inquisitive or over-cynical. You come out with the most abominable things man has ever uttered, and you expect us to accept them. Usually headlines, usually illogical, not just probably wrong. So, fleas are born pregnant.
Are they?
Interesting.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
See?
On we go.
So
see, that's true, and you're not impressed. Because it doesn't involve a little werewolf child. Or half man, half shark. It's not good enough for you.
No, but what if I read the first line of something, and it's not that interesting, I go, next, right, and I move on. Now, when I saw a woman had a baby, and it had a baby,
but
I
you
go,
still
ooh.
Didn't read on.
No, but, alright, I didn't read on, but it got me thinking. Like I said, you wonder about the parents' evening. I was thinking about, you know, is it a good thing? Because you're gonna spend more time with the kid. Do you know what I mean? There's a lot of mums who have to go out of work and that. She's going to be a great mum. Grew up with her, literally.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
So she's going to be a great mum!
I just wonder if- I know it sounds weird, but if
was
it's-
Was it the you know the baby that woman had? Was that a girl or a boy?
Well, it would have been a girl, wouldn't it?
Of course it would. It'd be mental, wouldn't it, if it wasn't?
And we just had an email from Dan. He says, my Mrs. Lynn is pregnant and is 8 days overdue. Carl, could you offer any words of encouragement to coax the baby down the birth canal? I've sat Lynn only inches away from the speaker to allow optimum audio transfer to the uterus. What would you say to that child there just to lure it out to the wide world, Carl?
I wouldn't rush out, to be honest. It's not good, is it? Out here.
Sure.
And I don't really want to talk about kids either, because Suzanne's mate's just had one and now she wants one.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Please never bring a child into the world, Carl. Promise us that.
They just bore me. Have you seen there's loads of people in the office who have got them now and they've all got baby pictures everywhere and they're all like, isn't it nice looking? And it's like, no, it's not. They all look the same. Do you know what I mean?
All like Mel Smith.
Just...
Don't they?
But it's that theory, actually, right? Do you know how I've said before about... babies, right, yeah. But like little old people.
Yeah.
There was, no.
Another of the great theories.
No, the fact that, you know, you're born, and you sort of, you know, you got no teeth, you got a little bald head, you yeah. can't control your bodily functions and that.
Sure.
Then you get to like-
Sorry,
70.
You're describing yourself.
Yeah, what? I was gonna say, you've got a dangerous ground,
no, I'm just
aren't
saying,
you?
That's how you're born.
Yep.
Then you get to about 70 or whatever.
Yeah.
All that starts to happen again, doesn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
Now, there was a story in America about- Just backing this up again, 70-year-old fella.
70-year-old fella, okay.
Little bald head.
Yeah.
Right? Probably no teeth and that.
Probably, yeah.
Nappy and that, right?
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Goes,
yeah.
Goes into
a 70-year-olds pop the old nappy on your 70th birthday, take your teeth out.
Goes into an off-license to get some beer, doesn't get served because he didn't think he was old enough.
Right. Okay. Right, okay.
Wait,
Carl's back.
Wait a minute,
no,
sorry. They thought he was
right,
a
okay,
giant baby that
right.
walked into
forget
the
weird, isn't it? Steve, forget it.
Carl, please.
Forget
I need
it.
Carl to answer.
No, that, I mean, that's a story, but it's weird, isn't it? That's
it's
what I'm
true.
Saying, it just backed up my
a guy in an off-license thought that a giant baby that had waddled into an off-license.
A 70-year-old wrinkled baby in an overcoat, stuck in Werther's Original, smoking a pipe and going, I can't believe it, the price is not the same as they were, right, was a small child.
Wow.
Yeah, weird, isn't it? Play a record, you're an idiot.
Right, what is the saying? Chucking a baby out with the bathwater?
Yeah.
Have you heard that phrase?
Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, how would you use that?
Well, how would I use that? Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. I suppose if you've, maybe you've been discussing something, you've come up with some plans, but you're slightly worried and, you know, you might abandon the whole plan, whereas there might be some ideas in there which are still worth retaining.
Exactly.
So you don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater.
There might be something you can just change and you don't really,
You know, there might be a few ideas you can salvage from an otherwise worthless one.
Well, the saying, right, comes from, like, years ago again.
Mm-hmm.
And,
pre or post phone?
And, ages and ages ago when, like, you know, the bloke worked in the house, you know, he was like the coal man, and then you had like-
No way, it's important.
Then like, the mum is like, you know, she stays at home making the dinner, looking after the kids.
Yep.
And you've got like the little kid who's just growing up, just messing about and stuff. So, what happens is, back then they didn't have like fresh flowing warm water every day.
Mm.
So all they could do, they could only afford to have like, one full big bath of fresh water. So they'd fill up the bath, right? And then the dad would come home and he'd say, oh, I've had a right, you know, I had a tough day at work and that down the pit. And his wife would say, it's all right, I'm putting the dinner on. You're going to have a nice warm bath.
So, because he gets the bath first.
Because he gets the bath first because he's the grafter.
And he's covered in coal.
He's covered in coal. So the water's like minging by the time he's finished.
Yeah.
Right? And then the wife says, oh, after all my cleaning the house and doing the cooking, I'm a bit sweaty now.
She's covered in dust and grime. She has
I'll have a bath, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
At the end of the line, there's a little baby.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been playing out all day. Also got like little grubby knees and stuff. Needs to have a bath.
Yeah.
It goes in the bath. Right? But because the water's so dirty.
Sure.
They go and empty the water out of the window. Can't see the baby in it. Chucking the baby out with the bathwater. That's where it comes from.
I don't know what to say, Steve. Because I've heard this. What do you think, Steve?
So. So, firstly, that sort of. I mean. That doesn't explain
where do you start? Well, you're struggling, aren't you? You're struggling where to start.
Well, firstly, I can't see how we've now applied this to,
I've been thinking of this for days, Steve, waiting for you to hear this one.
These coal mining parents can be negligent.
Yeah. I love
they've left their baby in the bath, unattended.
That's the way round to do it. The one covered in coal.
Yeah.
You go first. Don't wash the baby and then get in that.
Yeah.
You one covered in coal goes first, that's the best idea.
Yeah.
Second most dirty one goes second, and then the clean little baby, I think we should do him last, because he's done nothing towards this family.
But more than that, Rick, leave him to his own devices.
Yeah.
Jack, I'm just gonna throw the water out.
Yeah.
In the bath.
Don't check
Have you checked that the baby's not in there?
Check,
no, I'm not even gonna waste my time checking.
You'd see a baby in there.
If a baby was in here, I'd be able to see it. I'm just gonna throw it out.
Yeah, I'm not even gonna look, to be honest, Jack. We've all had our bath.
Yeah.
If the baby's in there, then it should be making
careful,
it sound
Jack. We have lost three children this way. Don't worry.
This isn't broadcasting, is it?
This is nothing. Come up with something.
Well, the fat baby then, the fat baby that they found that was on the telly.
Right. Well, what was that?
It's just a little fat baby. That, I don't know what, it's just a little fat kid and that.
What was on the telly? You just said fat baby on telly. You're meant to be telling them what's happened in the world. Tell me about the fat baby on telly.
It's just they've found some, there's this illness called Momo, right? And, they've just got this woman had a kid. It's really sad, it was on Channel 4 and that, right? And, kid's born.
You sure it wasn't Jimmy Carr?
Kid's born and that, right?
Momo?
It's called Momo,
isn't that
a
Black Music Award?
No, no, right, little fat baby and that, and there's only three of them in the world, these little fat babies.
Right.
And,
so
one of them-
they're in danger. How fat? Are you not telling- what do you mean? How fat are they?
6 stone it was only two. And, there's three of them in the world, and there was this one, and there was one in Brazil.
Are they, like, endangered? Is that the problem? Because there's only three of them in the world.
I don't
know. Worried? Is it like a conservation campaign?
They're hunted for their flesh. No, it's sad. If you I know, it's easy to joke on that, but if you've seen it, you'd go, it's a bit sad than that.
Well, I haven't seen it and I know nothing about it.
Well, I've told you, there's three of them in the world. When you've been saying I've got around Ed, I was a bit like, yeah, everyone has. Stop having a go.
Yeah.
And then I saw this picture last week. I thought, God, he's right.
Can't we just pop it on the XFM website?
I'd rather not.
I'll go on.
Steve, have you seen that man in a jar without a brain?
Sorry, is that something? Is that a product you can buy? In like Sainsbury's?
Is it a dream you had yesterday? You wondered if you could. Can I? Yes, hello. Could you make my dream into reality, please? We can't actually, sir. In plastic would be good.
Sorry, what do you mean?
In the future, you'll be able to download your dreams and then just like act them out again, probably in the year 2000 or something.
Soothsayer.
Now, there's some museum somewhere.
Yeah.
That's got this little fella who was born without a brain. And he's in a jar, and it's just that he's got a really round head.
Right.
And when I saw this picture, I thought, God, it just reminded me of this little fella in a jar.
Hold on, what do you mean he's born without a brain?
He was born without a brain.
So it's a baby?
It's not a little fella.
Yeah, but it's weird.
Do you know the difference? Do you have conversations with, like, people in prams thinking, that fella's little and he doesn't talk much?
Yeah.
You know babies aren't, like, little people?
Well, maybe.
Well, they are little people, but I mean, they're not very small adults. They're not like midgets.
They don't do a job of work, is what we're saying.
Yeah, you're very there. What do you mean?
I didn't read about it. I just saw the picture. And
this is where you're going wrong, Carl. This is always your mistake. You see the picture, you don't read the little cat.
But what do you mean? How do you
guess at what you think the meaning?
But how did you know it didn't have a brain?
He said something like the brainless man.
Yeah, but people say that about you. It doesn't mean you literally you haven't got a spinal cord.
I bet somebody's seen it and knows what I mean. It's a famous picture.
Right, call in 08700 800 1234. Once again, you win a prize if you can tell us what Carl is talking about. Just in general, it's an ongoing competition. We're trying to find some CDs to anyone who knows what Carl is talking about. Well, we've had calls confirming that there was indeed a fetus or a stillborn child.
A pickled baby.
A pickled baby. No wonder it died. Born without a brain. But everyone has, you know, pointed out that it wasn't a little fella.
It certainly wasn't a little fella.
No, no. But
because it had been in the jar for a long time, I think it had aged a bit.
What are you basing that on?
You do carry on growing, yeah. Yeah.
Well, your ears and your nose.
Your ears and your nose. And your eyes don't grow, so, yeah. You could probably, yeah.
I'll dig it out for you.
Yeah.
Imagine if like, there was an experiment where they were raising a child just based on the information that we said on the radio.
Yeah.
What kind of a person would like they download,
yeah.
What kind of information would they
have? And it took everything literally.
Exactly.
And I think, yeah, there's no irony or, yeah, it was just.
They just, everything we said they assumed was fact. Everything Carl said.
And any question it had about the world, it could only ask Carl.
Exactly.
And it
see, now, this worries me because without wishing to be disrespectful in any way, Carl, you know I think you're the best man on earth. When you have a child, we could be in a situation a bit like that. Do you know, is it a concern for you, do you think, that, like, when your son's growing up or your daughter, they're asking you questions, you're conscious, I mean, you yourself have admitted that you have a sphere of knowledge which you are an expert on.
Ask your mother.
You'd say ask your mother.
That's good.
That's great, fair enough.
That's good.
And I'd play with it. I think I'd be a good dad.
Yeah, sure. I think you would.
But I wouldn't be the one who's shouting at it.
No.
No. Who would you get to shout at it? But I mean, Windsor Davis. He'd be good, wouldn't he? You horrible little man!
Well, you know, I'd tell it the rights and wrong. You don't have to be a really bright person to know the rights and wrong in the world.
Yeah. No. I think you are bright, Carl.
You are. And at what point in their life would you tell them about the evolution of the baguette? Which you told us.
Or the story of the bee.
Yes.
That you scored once.
Or the two children. Would you ever get them to meet as maybe like that? They could be godparents. The friends you had at school.
Yeah.
Webbed hands.
Friends.
That weren't friends.
Oh, I wish we could track them down.
Oh, that'd be great.
I imagine they're in a zoo.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. Two big jars. Industrial strength jars. Oh, dear.
What do you make of the, what do you make of the first genetically modified baby?
Oh.
Are you worried about these?
Do you know what did they do? What?
Let me see what it says here.
Isn't it just choosing the, you know, eye colour.
Well, this is the concern, isn't it? That in the future you'll be able to decide whether it's a boy or a girl, how intelligent it is, what it looks like, is it handsome, is it ugly. Obviously, no one will choose an ugly baby, and so on and so on and so on. And so, it means that you know where will it lead? Where will it end, Carl? Are you concerned?
I've thought about this a lot.
What will us three look like in the future if they're being, you know, genetically modified beautiful people? What will we be like? How will we be considered in society? True, yeah.
But we've talked about this before, haven't we? About the cloning thing.
Yeah,
that's a bit weird.
Yeah.
But I don't think it matters because at the end of the day, right, you might look like some other kid, but it's the way you're brought up that will change your features and the way you are, you know, your personality.
If you lie, you get a long nose, don't you?
Well, no, but listen, right, because I remember when we, you know, I was growing up on this estate.
This is going to be good. Go on.
No, No, it's not. It's just an example of how this doesn't work.
Go on. So
we don't need to worry, sort of thing.
Sure.
Right?
Okay.
So growing up on this estate, and there was a this woman about 4 houses down. Right, it was a bit rough. Right.
Didn't fancy her.
Oh God, no. Right, but she had a baby.
Well, tell me about her first. I'm interested in this woman. Why was she?
It was a very.
Was it like a man in a dress?
I mean, I didn't grow up in a posh house or anything. And I'm not saying that if you live in a bit of a rough house, you're a bad person.
What did she look like?
But anyone can clean up.
Looked like Tony Green with a fag on.
They didn't clean up much, right?
Oh.
Which, even if you've not got a lot of money, you can still try and make a place look nice.
Yeah.
Right? But she didn't. And a kid used to take a horse into the house.
Sorry.
Whoa, Neddy.
What do you mean a kid used to take a horse into the house? Where did he get a horse?
Must have nicked it from somewhere. Must have.
Is he using a horse? No.
What, is that from outside the saloon round the corner?
Yeah, was it just tied up with a bit of
leather?
Right. Oh, that's great. Big Jake, come looking for it.
I been out.
Oh. Sorry, let me get this. This was before the lynching stopped or after.
Where did he get a horse from? What do you mean he must have nicked it? His mum said, where'd you get that from? I bought it. All right then, but keep it out the kitchen.
I don't want you going Catelyn rustling.
Oh, where did he get a horse from, Carl? And how long did he have it for? Was he leading it or riding it? Mum, open the door, I can't stop!
I can't stop it! Open the patio door as well, I'll be-
Looks like we got us a runaway! What do you mean?
I don't know, but the thing is, they couldn't afford to buy one because they're not cheap. So I'm just guessing. Maybe that's wrong of me. But I think-
He had a horse?
Yeah, right, so-
That's why the family didn't have any money, they'd spend it on the horse!
No, exactly! That's what I'm saying, I don't think they would have bought it. So anyway-
Yeah, it's wise to whisper, Carl, in case they're listening.
Yeah, and
they could be in the room next door.
It's not buying it, it's keeping it as well. So I
was like in the car with my dad coming into the avenue, and you used to have to drive down it to turn round, and, and you know, sort of go back to our house.
You had the traditional method of transport, yeah.
And the horse was in the lounge,
reading a paper,
just like walking around.
What?
And when I was doing, I tried to earn myself some money once by flogging little flowers in plastic cups.
What? This is genius. It just keeps coming. What do you mean you're trying to flog little flowers? What do you mean?
Wait. Let's play a record. Let's play a record and come back to this, because the story's going to just unravel and unravel. It's going to go for hours. Let's play a track,
Carl. It gets deeper and deeper. It's like an onion, isn't it?
We've created a whole world here where there's a man living with a horse.
Just walking around the lounge.
I mean, I come from the West Country. I've never heard anything like that.
I just think of a big sort of like orange carpet, and it's got a rediffusion telly, and this horse going, I'm fed up in here.
Exactly.
This is really-
I am not taking the rubbish out again.
Yeah.
We got onto genetically modified babies, but
and
somehow
then Carl started telling a story about someone with a horse, and then he got onto he was trying to make money selling flowers. Just do the flowers.
Well, hang on, I just want to recap slightly. So there was a family, and who had the horse in the family?
It was
because you lived on an estate in Manchester.
The mother was a right pig, apparently. Well, I don't know where that's relevant.
You don't need to go that far.
But what
I'm trying to do is like make a picture for you, so you understand
what a picture like? It is. Who did she look like?
Bit of a and no disrespect to her. Bit like Pauline Quirk.
Quirky, yep.
Right?
Okay. I knew you were going to say that. Yeah. I knew it was going to be Pauline. Did she have any tats? Did she have any tats?
I never got that close to her.
Okay, alright.
So, and so who had the horse? Was this her son or her husband?
No, her daughter.
Her daughter had stolen a horse?
Yeah, from, I don't know where, there was a, I think it was some stables down the road or something.
And they kept the horse in the house with them?
They kept it in the house.
Did they get caught?
It for long.
No.
So, and you said you were in the house one day and you saw the horse
in there? What happened was, I was, they did this thing at school about raising money for charity, right? For some local charity. And they said you can do anything to raise money, and they came out with all these ideas, and I thought, that's good.
What was the charity?
Well, forget, well, I don't know, I thought, forget the charity.
Yeah, that's I'm just a good money making overweight.
So, you're a charity.
So, so I asked my mum for some, because she used to have a lot of flowers around the house.
Sure.
I said, can I just take some snippings off them? And, I'll go and buy some plastic cups. And, got some soil out of the garden. Planted the bits of plants in them.
Yeah.
Got a tray.
Yeah.
Had about 25 plants on it, selling them for 25 pence each.
Excellent. Did you sell any?
Yeah, so loads.
So they, did you just cut, you didn't just cut them and stick them in
the
soil?
Yeah, they wouldn't have survived.
Oh.
But I think people sort of thought, well, good on him for trying. But anyway, so I went round to theirs, because I thought their house could do with a bit of colour and stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's a bit rough. So, as I went
the horse went, thank God for that breakfast. They've been feeding me kitty cat.
So I got up to the door, and they opened the door, and it was one of them houses where no carpet.
Yeah, a horse in the living room.
You know.
We've all been there.
And the horse was walking around the living room. Oh. I looked quite happy and everything, because I always say that about animals.
Black Beauty was on.
Yeah. Well, think about it, right? If you were a horse, where would you rather be? In a little wooden hut with a load of hay? Or in, like, a house with a,
central heating,
three-piece suite, and a telly and that?
Telly and that!
Because, no, but I was saying this the other day, right?
And an Atari.
Right? I was walking through London.
Commodore 64, yeah, rubbish.
Exactly.
Walking through London with Suzanne, right? Yeah. And you know, like, homeless people always have dogs. And she said, oh, I hope she looks after it. And I said, they've got, that dog is happier than most dogs.
Right.
Because people always walk past and give it a pat on the head.
Yeah.
It's with its owner all the time.
Yeah.
It's out in the open, it's not locked up in a house.
Yeah.
It doesn't eat, but other than that.
No, it does eat though, they're always all right. So that's what I was saying. I think this horse was doing all right for itself. Do you know?
Well, not many horses have got their own house.
Exactly.
For a start, yeah.
But anyway, that's
that's by the by.
Yeah, yeah, so anyway, this family, it was a bit, what we were talking about, it was about cloning.
Genetically modified kids and all that stuff,
Right, now what I'm saying is, you could say, you know, right, Steve, you could have a baby, right? Mm-hmm. And Ricky could see it and say, God, I want one that looks like that.
Yeah.
Right?
It could happen, Rick.
So
come on, work with him.
So you take it to your doctors, and I don't know what they do, they inject it with something or whatever.
Yep, that's how it's done.
Yeah.
And get a little baby, and there it is, it looks the same. Now the thing is, you separate, you both go off and do your own things.
Yep.
Right? Yeah. Now, you look at Stephen, this is, you look after your baby.
Yeah.
You treat it well, you give it good food and
I'm
that,
a good dad.
All the vitamins and stuff.
Mm. Yeah.
Ricky just gives it cheese. Right? So then it changes its looks, it goes a bit fat. You know, it gets tired easily, and that sort of thing. Now, when this family-
Why am I just feeding a baby cheese?
Right, this family had a horse in their house.
Yeah.
They had a little baby. And my mum went round and said, you're not gonna believe this, but it's a beautiful looking baby. Right?
Yeah.
And I was like, well, you know. And the weird thing is, it was a good looking kid. But as time went on, they didn't really look after it. And I'm not saying, like, abusing it, but it used to run around, it used to play out till, like, 10 at night.
Yeah.
It used to chase cars.
Right.
It was a bit...
Did it have hooves?
Yeah, no. No. Chase cars!
Right.
What sort of kid chases cars? Oh, God. Now, was it called Rover? The weird Did it catch sticks?
It's Liam, it was called, right?
Right.
Now, the weird thing is, it was a good looking kid, but as time went on, and all that, like, not eating properly and its hair was all patchy.
It's not Liam Gallagher, is it?
And chasing cars and that, and it became an ugly kid.
It's definitely Liam Gallagher.
And that's what I'm saying, right? You can you can clone all you like, but at the end of the day, it's that you brought up.
Brilliant.
Wow. Wow. Life.
Wow.
That was a hell of a point.
Oh, God.
But am I right?
You're always right, Carl.
Well, like, when you're born, you're a little baby, wrinkly and stuff. When you get older, you sort of morph into a baby again. And you go through the same phases. So when you're young, you buy singles. You get old, you've got nothing to do all day. You got all your pension money. What will I buy? Cliff Richard's on the telly. Here's my video, buy me song.
You see, that started off as quite a sensible point, because I actually think I'd do it. But what was all that alien stuff about when you're born, you go wrinkly and you go wrinkly again? So sometimes you mix, like, normal things that human beings say with I don't know what.
Well, look, when you're a baby, you've got a little bald head, no teeth, you get old, what happens?
Are you a philosopher? Are you an official philosopher? Because, I mean, it sounds like it.
Do you know, the other week when I came up with, like, a different idea of how we can sort of make the world run and that.
Can we just have a quick recap of that? Because I seem to remember it was a load of old arse.
It was ridiculous. It was he was saying that the world is overpopulated, so the system would be where people were living too long and stuff. So what happens is people live till 78. I don't know how you can enforce that, right? No. But when they die, they've got a little baby in their stomach, right, like a pip in an apple, that then carries on when they die.
Right.
It wasn't a theory. It wasn't an idea. It was the ramblings of a mental case.
You're saying it's stupid, but someone's emailed in and said, "Oh yeah, that's pretty good." Just saying, if that's a no, right, I've been thinking
about... It is
about,
a no.
What about if we do it the other way, right?
Ah, oh, go on.
Somehow, I don't know how
A kid has an old lady?
Hey, that's what it's gonna be, isn't it? A child no. give birth to an old man.
No. Right. What I'm saying is, right?
Go on.
Work the other way round.
Come on, then.
So if somehow we can inject something in like a body that's just died, right?
Listen to this. Imagine, shh. But well, imagine this is notes. So when he hands it into the Nobel people,
yeah.
and they go, if there's a way that we can inject something, they go, well, what? Well, I don't know the chemical formula, but something HO2. Right.
So anyway, so you inject it in the temple.
He's narrowed it down to the temple. So what happens?
She sort of wakes up, amazing. Right? And she works the other way. So, like, she might be 77.
Yep.
And then she'll have a birthday, she's 76. And she's working that way.
Right.
If you know what I mean.
Okay.
Are you with me?
No, keep it.
Because, the thing is, you've got...
I no
I'm
idea.
Really scared.
Yeah.
I'm really scared. This is the maddest thing you've ever said.
Yeah.
This is madder than the old lady with the pip like an apple in her belly.
It sort of did work.
This is
no, it didn't work. It worked in your head. It's like a dream that you wake up and go, oh, I've got a great theory.
This is
like,
what this is it. Let me just tell you the ending, because the ending's works out a bit better.
Go on.
What I'm saying is, when you die at the age of
78.
9 months.
What?
At the age of 9 months, because that's when you come out.
What do you mean when you die at the age of 9 months?
You're not scared of dying because you're now a baby, so you don't know what's going on anyway. So there's no fear.
So you've missed out a bit here. So this woman, what, literally gets younger and younger?
I think when she's in her 20s, she's in her old age, Rick.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter because that's the fun part of your life, isn't it? When you're 20 and you've got all your energy and that. So before you die, you're actually having a good life rather than it being the other way around.
But does she do different stuff than she did on the way up? Because she's already lived 78 years, hasn't she? Don't forget. She was a baby once, and she grew 10 years, then someone stuck a needle in her head and said, right, back you go.
No, we'll forget all that bit.
How do we forget that bit?
What I'm saying
so
is...
So she died, and she doesn't remember all her... This is a new life, is it?
Let me just leave you with this.
Right, you're talking shit. Explain yourself.
But aren't the family getting younger as well? What's happened to the family?
Forget it then, we'll leave it as it is.
No, leave it as it is, shall we?
Can we all agree on that, guys? No. Should we agree to leave it as it is? Is that all right? Because I don't want to hear any more from the diaries of Charles Manson.
No, it's... I mean, you're a fucking maniac.